To end this episode, we had the first part of Guardian's Crusade, a game I bought after just watching a video listing obscure PS1 games and thought it would be an interesting game to try out for this show. Then it took me nearly 2 years to actually play it. Since this is an RPG, I'll quickly go over what my goal is to consider this game fully complete. I will be completing every side quest, obtaining every treasure, and maxing out the number of every item, along with obtaining all of our AI partners' transformations. However, for the first time, I will not be reaching the game's level cap. I'll go over it more near the end of the game, but the quick version is that, like maxing all the parts in Beyblade, it's a task that goes way beyond reasonable mainly because the level cap is absurdly high. Although I do reach a level that's pretty ridiculous anyway, and I doubt many players have got as high level as I did. On starting a new game, we get to see a stork carrying a baby through a thunderstorm before he gets attacked by monsters and all three of them are struck by lightning, causing the stork to drop the baby. We then cut to inside the house of our sleeping main character, where he's woken up by this fairy, Nahani. We have a chance to name ourselves, but I just stick with the canon name, Knight. Nahani nags him to wake up, telling him that the mayor was looking for him. So Knight gets dressed and goes outside. We start the game in Orgo Village at level 1 with 100 rubies, the game's currency. We start equipped with a short sword, leather armour, wooden helmet and wooden shield, and two key items, called junk for some reason. These are the Knight's Courage, inherited from his father, and Smile, from his mother. I can also talk to Nahani whenever I want if I need to remind myself of the current objective. First thing I do is turn on fast battle mode to make things go faster. Before talking to the mayor, I have some items to collect. Even in empty houses like this one, Nahani seems to have a comment for just about every single object he can inspect. In the house directly north of Knight's, I can inspect a bookshelf and have Nahani tell me I can't take the money in one of the books because it doesn't belong to me. In the same house, I can inspect this barrel to find a rusted toy. She doesn't object to me stealing this though, she even says we should take it. Not to mention these crates. First she tells me I shouldn't be looking through other people's things, but as soon as there's something interesting inside, she's into it as well. This crate gets me a dusty toy. We can't use the toys just yet, but it helps to get collecting them out of the way. East of that house is the mayor's house. When inside, I go east into another room and then out into his flower garden where I can steal a mind berry growing from one of them. This is an item that cures confusion. Back inside, I enter the mayor's room and talk to him to find he has an errand for me. He wants me to deliver a letter to Mayor Kaelin of San Claria. He also gives me an angel's tear, which cures poison. The town's vegetable crop isn't harvested and bad things are also apparently happening in San Claria, and he just wants Kaelin's opinion on whether or not they should be worrying. He also tells me to ask Mary for a snack to take on the journey. Mary is the woman outside an empty house slightly northwest of Knight's. She gives me a candy bar, a healing item. To the southwest is the farm where I can have the farmers complain to me about the bad harvest. One of them talks about his son Algo, who he sent to gather mushrooms once. He talks about how his child was attacked by monsters and, exhausted, accidentally ate a toadstool and nearly paralysed himself. His fault? What an idiot. I enter the nearby building and inspect a box to find a sick weed, and next to it a chest containing a cute toy. Back to the houses and west takes me out into the wilderness, which is basically the game's equivalent to a world map. But the entire game world, outside of buildings and caves and the like, is all on one large screen. Instead of random encounters, enemies are seen wandering around as ghosts that trigger battles on contact. This first enemy is a Neugen. Right now all I can do is attack and use items. This is one of the weakest enemies in the game and dies in 2 hits at level 1, but one attack still takes over half of my starting HP. However, I can rest for a free full heal in my house. Sleeping at my house or at inns is also the only way you can save your game. So I get to grinding first before I try and go anywhere. My second battle gets me to level 2. So I just continue to follow the path, looking for more enemies in the grass and around the trees. A couple fights later is another new enemy, the little worm. It dies in one hit and I get the XP to reach level 3. I can face up to 2 enemies at once in this game. It's not long before I reach level 4. At one point I go through some trees to reach the edge of the land and find a monkey tail. These might be a threat for a level 1 knight, but 3 levels later they only do 1 damage to me and die in 2 hits. My next fight after that gets me to level 5. Slightly northwest gets me to a beach, and I'm now so high level for these enemies that the ghosts went from pink to white and now actively avoid me, so I have to chase them down. That's because this jellyfishman also dies in a single hit. With that I get following the road northwest, taking out any enemies that get near. Eventually I reach a sign saying that San Claria is to the west of here. It's only a few steps from the sign. One thing I really like about this game's soundtrack is that every single town has its own unique theme, which you wouldn't really expect from an obscure RPG from the late 90s. Even Final Fantasy 7 and 8 didn't have unique tracks for every town. I bring this up because when I made the music ranking video months in advance before writing this script, I was surprised at how much I really liked Sanclaria's theme for such a minor track you'll hear for about 2 minutes at the beginning of the game, and then never again. I don't know what's going on with the people who live here though. I don't know if that's some kind of mask or they have disturbing xenomorph heads with one giant eye. So I get a free stay at the inn because business is struggling since the bridge to the town washed away. I don't know why I'll give myself away for free then. In terms of flavour, there's this poet reciting something about a Julia, only for Julia to be hiding behind the nearest building listening in. The mayor's house is next to Julia. I go upstairs and give him the letter. He asks me to tell our mayor he has nothing to worry about. Our bad crops and their lack of the town's signature furfish is just a coincidence and things will sort themselves out. Before leaving, I go into his bathroom and steal a go-go bean from his shelf. Leaves Q asleep. In the northwest corner of town, there's a house on the beach. Inside is a chest with a wind-up toy. That's all I need to do in this town? Seems a cozy place and, once again, great music. Not my favourite track, but it's up there. Definitely my favourite town theme though. Now to get back to Argo. My first battle on the way back gets me to level 6. As I reach my hometown's entrance, there's a pink Moomin looking thing just hanging in the middle of the road. If I try talking to it, a light shines down from the sky and an old man appears. He says it's Knight's destiny to deliver this baby to its mother, who lives in God's Tower. And you know, the usual, darkness, don't fuck it up. Nahari has no idea what that was about, but the baby is now following us. She suggests we ask the mayor for his advice. The mayor thinks I got poisoned and hallucinated it all, because he believes that monsters don't have parents, just curses. So he thinks the baby is the cause of the bad harvest. The next day he wants me to take the baby to the Cave of Fear and abandon it there. He's so sure that the next morning he's managed to convince Nahani that it was an illusion after all. So time to run along the same path for a third time. Now the baby will appear in battles but run before the fight can start. This time when I reach the sign, I take the east path towards Grave Road. I soon reach level 7. Grave Road itself is straightforward with a grave for the hero Sir Darwin at the end. But along it is a side path north that also turns west and east at points. Along this path I get two new enemies in a single fight, the weak jester and the goofy looking dino. One of them drops a long sword when I kill it, which is 1 point stronger than my short sword. My next battle is against another new enemy, the Bonefly. My next battle gets me to level 8. At the end of the path is a broken bridge and next to it the entrance to the Cave of Fear. Nahani tells him to be careful and we see him off inside, although it's clear he doesn't want to go alone. The sign next to the cave says that terrible demons are inside, but I'm sure it'll be fine. Now it's time to head back. A fight with some bone flies has one drop some padded armour, a 1 point increase in defence of the leather armour. Then Knight reaches level 9. I stop by Sanclaria and stay at the inn. In his sleep, Knight relives the talk of his destiny with ... and the next morning decides he's going to find the baby again. On the way back to the Cave of Fear, he reaches level 10. Before, Nahani would stop me entering the cave, but now I can go in. In the cave, this first screen is very linear, so I just follow the tunnel. My first battle is against a Bearophant, this gross blue drowsy lookalike. Not much else in this room, so at the end, I go through the entrance to the next. This next room is just as straightforward. I battle my first snake right here. At this point, I'm killing most things with one hit. Just before the next room's entrance, I can rotate the camera to find a chest against the wall containing a candy bar. Majority of the chests in dungeons are hidden by the default camera angle. I enter the next room. This one seems just as simple until I reach a fork towards the end. Between north and east, I take the northern path to a new room. It just has a chest with a mysterious toy inside. I go back and take this next exit. In here, there's a huge dragon skull with a chest inside that contains a cool toy and a bronze shield. It's 2 points stronger than the wood shield. After this, I reach level 11, and from the skull, I head east into another room. This room is a few steps north to another fork. I go west and then north to another room. Following this path, I meet my first new enemy since the first room, the Blue Boy. The strongest monster faced so far, it deals around a sixth of my current max health with an attack and is the first that can survive 2 attacks from me. Following the path some more leads to another fork. First I go east across a bridge to a chest with a hamburger inside, then back across and north to the next exit. Before reaching it though, I face my first Fauntus. Its main attack animation is just insane. Right away in this next room, I go north for a chest with a bronze sword inside. It's 1 point stronger than the longsword. Now it's time to backtrack to the fork 2 rooms ago. On the way back is my first fat bat enemy. This battle gets Knight to level 12. Back at the previous fork, I go east into the next room. This room has 3 of these green people guarding the entrance to the town Kell. Nahani explains to them why we are here. The Kellians decide to take us to their elder. One of them leads me over to the elder and tells him what we're after. He'll only tell us where the baby went if we do something for them first. Their tribe is being terrorised by a monster called a Mushmare, and is currently in the storage room eating their supplies. We just have to kill it to get our information. But first we get to explore the town a little. There's a tent in the southeast where I can take a toadstool from a barrel. The Kellyan in there tells us why the Mushmare is attacking. Someone tried to cook him in his sleep. In a tent on the east end of town, you can find a magic pill to make night grow taller, but a jealous Nahani won't let him take it. In the centre east of town is a Kellyan who lets you sleep in his tent for free. In the southwest corner of town, I can find another toadstool in a well. I really stress over which items to toss while I still have the limited inventory, as I don't want to throw away a limited item. Much later, it will turn out that all that stressing was pointless. North of the inn tent is another where I can take another free toadstool from a jar in exchange for agreeing to kill the Mushmare. East of that tent is the entrance to the storage room. The Mushmare is just standing there pulsating, so I slowly walk up to start the fight. The annoying thing about bosses in this game is that all of them deactivate the fast battle option, so you have to play at the default speed. And after hours of fast battles, it feels much slower than it actually is. I don't know why things need to be slowed down. This isn't ATB, we just take turns attacking. Apart from that, the first boss is very easy. He only has 86 HP and I deal over 30 with an attack. He has a blood-sucking attack that heals him by the damage he deals to me, but it doesn't help and I kill him with just 3 attacks. He also drops an iron sword on death. It's a 2-point attack increase over the bronze sword. I continue the Mushmare's activities though and steal a hamburger from a box in the corner. A Kellyan takes me back to the Elder. In return, he opens a door behind himself and says that the baby should be back there. He also rewards us with a wind-up toy. We wind it up and it starts talking to us. He introduces himself as Mr. O'Neill. He's one of many living toys. He says that they were created by Professor Zepetto to make the world a better place. He was the first living toy created to help people out in battles. This is what all those toys I've been collecting earlier are for. Using PP, or psychic points, I can use a living toy for some kind of special function. They're basically this game's version of standard RPG magic spells. The toys I collected before have been removed from the junk section and are now in a new living toy menu. So far I have 7. There's Cupid who heals the party a little. Dark Possil deals darkness damage to the enemies. Jupiter deals light damage. O'Neill beats the enemies with his baton. Nurse heals a single party member. Pyro deals fire damage to a single enemy. Finally, Viper paralyzes enemies with a blow dart. The Elder also said there was another stashed away in the storage room. When I return, there is a new chest containing Da Bomb. The bomb charges up over a few turns before exploding, damaging both the party and all enemies. I can also search this bag for a peach potion, which restores a small amount of PP. Outside of O'Neill, none of the living toys have any story presence, but I think they're a neat, unique way to go about the usual RPG skills and spells. A nice way to have a collection side quest that directly benefits you gameplay-wise. Back in the Elder's house, I can take another peach potion from a jar. I then go through the newly opened door. The tunnel leads to this fancy gate. Inside is another door I can't open, but there's a hole in the west wall I can go through. First is an empty room going west some more into a much larger room. Halfway through the room I go south into another room with a chest containing the living toy Phoenix. It removes all status effects. Back to the large room and I go all the way northwest to the next room. I then go north into a room overlooking a waterfall. North a little and there's a chest to the east containing the living toy Walk Bomb. This one logs every single step I take and then converts those steps into damage when I use it, which then resets the counter to zero. I decide I'm going to save it for the final boss to see how much damage I can build up. Then it's northwest through another exit. It looks like this room has a fork, but both paths rejoin after a bit. But the western path has a chest hidden away with a candy bar inside. Then it's north into the next room where I can see the baby sleeping in a giant nest. But I run right past him and go north to the next room so I can open a chest for a bronze mail, a point stronger than the padded armour. I then return to check on the baby. He talks in his sleep about not being able to eat anymore. Then Nahani sees the broken eggshells around him and connects the dots, just in time for the angry parent to appear. The Gale Stalk has 206 HP. I start by calling out Da Bomb. After it hits me for about a fifth of my health, Nahani also slaps it for a single digit damage, which is a random occurrence that can happen. I get a couple hits in myself and when it comes time for Da Bomb to explode, I set Knight to defend, taking no damage while the Gale Stalk takes over 130, finishing it off. Knight also reaches level 13. I obtain the living toy Time Out, which makes everything in the battle invincible for 3 turns. Nahani says we only knocked out the Gale Stalk so there's no need to kill it since it was only defending its nest. She also sees light coming from further on. The baby gives Knight a heavy stone. Nahani can understand what the baby is saying, but before they can speak more, the Gale Stalk wakes up. It chases everyone through the next screen and out of the cave where there's just a cliff edge, resulting in everyone falling after Nahani isn't strong enough to hold the others. We wake up in a bedroom being looked after by an old couple, Amos and Martha. Amos found us floating down the river and brought us to his home to heal. Nahani fills them in on everything that's happened so far. After that, the conversation is interrupted by this kid, Bonic. He was the one who physically carried us here after Amos found us. He's staying in the room next door if we need him. He's also very loud and doesn't get why we'd want to go to God's Tower, as there'd be no one there to sell things to. Since it's night, everyone gets a bit of sleep. But Knight can't sleep, so I go next door and talk to Bonic. I can look at what he has to sell, including a gun that's free. But he refuses to sell it as he's holding onto it for another customer. Is Bonic an arms dealer? He does give me a free hamburger though, and then a free cheeseburger, followed by some bubblegum, and then a terror seed, which I'll never use. He says if I'm going to God's Tower, I'll be needing to go east through Istan. At this point everyone goes to sleep, and the next morning, Bonic has already left. I go downstairs and talk to Martha. She wishes everyone a good morning, but blanks on the baby's name, making Nahani realise we don't know it yet either. And so we get to name him, and after all the build-up, the baby's canonical name is... Baby. Baby likes it, so we're sticking with it. Talking to Amos has him gift us a living toy to help us reach God's Tower. Mapster just shows us the entire world map. Nahani thanks a couple for their help, and we leave. Now Baby's officially in the party, he also acts as an item bank, so I can fit every single item inside him at 100 copies each too. Baby has an affection system too, which influences how he fights, since he is AI controlled. Feeding him items and giving him orders in battle helps with his affection. Feeding Baby equipment can also increase his stats, but it's not very useful, especially this early as the weak equipment will rarely have any effect. As for his go fetch option, I'll deal with that towards the end of the game. Since Baby starts at level 1, I'm going to level him up a bit first. My first battle here gets me two new enemies, Giant Ant and Ogre. Right now Baby is weak, his basic chomp only doing single digit damage, but Knight is strong enough to carry him. The first fight gets him to level 2. Two more fights later and he hits level 3, then level 4 the next fight. When I need to heal, I can simply return to the Coastal Inn for a free rest. The next fight after my rest gets Baby to level 5, then level 6 two fights later. Knight also reaches level 14 the next fight, and the next fight gets Baby to level 7. Five battles more get Baby to level 8, then to level 9 after four more fights. Another four battles get him to level 10, then Knight reaches level 15 from the very next battle. Four more get Baby to level 11. Time to get going now. I go north from the inn and then east across this bridge. I keep going east along the edge of a land until I have no choice but to go south. The path goes southeast, then east some more until I reach a sign saying that Eastern is further southeast. Moving past the sign has us walking on the confrontation. It turns out that gun Bonic was selling was faulty and nearly killed the user. This guy was supposed to be fighting in a mayoral election, so they demand him give them a stand-in fighter. Though Bonic claims he would never sell a faulty weapon and wants to check it himself. That's when we interfere and Bonic accuses him of lying. His opponent is also using a stand-in for the election, and so this guy is clearly faking an injury to get out of facing him. The man ignores this and just decides that Knight is going to be his stand-in. Bonic points out that Knight has nothing to do with this, so the man has his henchmen shadily take Bonic away to look at this weapon. Once he's gone, the man introduces himself as Richton. He's now threatening us to fight in the election in exchange for Bonic's life. And so he takes us to his house in Istan. We can't leave town, but he has booked a room for me at the inn, how kind. As long as I don't leave town, I'm free to explore it. The first notable thing I find is in the southwest corner near the cafe, where there's a huge dragon named Ikbee just standing there who I can talk to. Nahani translates what she's saying. She thinks Baby is cute, and I was surprised to agree. When I first saw him in that intro FMV, I was like, the fuck is that thing? But his design grew on me quickly. In the most southwest corner is a chest containing the living toy Kimoni, who heals better than Cupid does. Half of my maximum health compared to the third that Cupid heals. But of course, Kimoni costs more. South of this wall is another chest containing Buccaneer mail for a 1-point increase over the bronze mail. I go inside the cafe and check the second pile of barrels against the wall for a single ruby to fall into my hands. At the counter we meet our opponent, Darkbeat. He's some kind of chosen one and the stand-in for Marco, Richton's rival. He seems pretty confident, saying he'll go easy on us and not hurt us. Based on comments from other NPCs, it seems this Marco is more popular with the townspeople. North of the cafe is a small house belonging to Marco. He's basically the most decent human being on the planet, genuinely glad that arsehole Richton found a stand-in and won't be stuck fighting Darkbeat himself. The only reason Marco isn't fighting is because he injured his back saving an old lady from being run over. I root around in his boxes upstairs to find a bug. These have no purpose other than to feed Baby, but since I'm getting the highest amount of every item, I'm hoarding this. Outside the house is a gambler who bet all of his money on me winning the fight. I can also bet on the fight myself, with Baby listed as a pig and Ikbee listed as a walrus. I bet 20 rubies on myself to find that my odds of winning are down as 20 to 1. I enter the inn and inspect the fireplace, causing a cheeseburger to fall out. I take it. Slightly east of Ikbee is the current mayor's house. Even he supports Marco over Richton. Then we find out exactly why Richton is even bothering. Erpi, the mayor, said that the next mayor gets to marry his daughter, Carmen. She's upstairs and wants us to lose on purpose so she can marry Marco. Marco is such a good guy that even with this on the line, he still asked her not to ask us to lose on purpose, out of fairness. I enter the town shop and buy myself a 200 ruby iron armour for one more point of defence, an iron helmet for 1050 rubies for an increase of 10 points, and another 200 for an iron shield and 2 more points of defence. With everyone spoken to, I return to the inn and turn in for the night. The next morning, Richton is waiting for me. He's pretending to be polite in front of the innkeeper and even says that Bonnick wishes as well. Outside, the mayor says, let the bravest man win, despite neither of them fighting. So Knight and Darkbeat face each other. Baby starts by trying to hit Ikbee with a hammer, but misses. Ikbee takes most of my health with a single tail whip. Then Darkbeat uses his horizon beam, which takes Knight out and leaves Baby at critical health. But Knight's defeat instantly ends the fight. Yeah, this one's unwinnable. When he fades back in, Nahani tells Knight to sleep off his wounds in the inn. Carmen visits, feeling bad about asking Knight to lose. Yeah, that's why I lost. It was intentional. When Knight is finally able to get out of bed, Nahani lets him know that Bonnick managed to get away safely. He came by to thank Knight, but had to rush to Zed Harbour. First thing I do is visit Marco, who was the one to rush me to the inn after being defeated. He apologises for Richton getting me involved. He says Knight will always be welcome here and pays us 500 rubies, giving us all his money so that as mayor, he can start again from scratch. Nahani asks if he knows how to get to God's Tower. He says I need to go east to Zed Harbour so that I can catch a ship to the eastern continent. Now I'm free to leave town, I get heading east like Marco said. I cross a bridge and head south. One of the new enemies I face here is the Snapdragon. It has its own health sealing attack, so it takes a couple turns to kill. A couple fights later, Baby reaches level 12. I finally check out Mapster so I can see what the world looks like and find that Zed Harbour is more south than east of Istan. So I just follow the road south until I find a sign saying that Zed Harbour is south and the desert is to the west. First I head west into this desert for a small grind. I face a sand ghost that would be a threat alone, but with two party members isn't a problem. Killing it gets Knight to level 16. Then the next one gets Baby to level 13. A couple of fights later and I meet a giant flea. I try out Pyro in this battle. He's one of many living toys who hangs around for a few turns and keeps fighting until an enemy defeats him, at which point he can't be used for the rest of the battle. Baby also uses his headbutt attack here, which stuns himself for a turn. It's also around here I try out Kimoni for the first time. I don't use every living toy I collect, but I'll show off the ones that do make an appearance. I return to the sign after a bit and keep going south. Baby reaches level 14 and I soon reach Zed Harbour. This town is going to become the bane of my life in the future. The guide I'm using says that late in the game, the shops will become inaccessible, so any items only sold here, I'll have to max out before then. Going down the street and taking the first turn east has me find a Sanclarian merchant who recognises me and says that the ship docked here is going to the eastern continent, but we need tickets. I go into the house directly north of him and inspect the plant inside to find a bug on it. In one house south from the gate is a man who spent his entire life watering a potted plant without realising it was a Christmas tree the entire time. Next to that house is the governor's residence. I go through the first door I pass into the governor's office and inspect this stand to find the buccaneer sword stashed behind it. He lost it there a while ago and lets us have it since it doesn't fit his style. It's 2 points stronger than the iron sword. I talk to the governor who asks if I'm old enough to vote, then tells me to get lost when I'm not. Nahani dislikes him. I can go upstairs and talk to his wife, who complains that no one else sees his good husband side, only his multiple twatish aspects. Wonder why. His son, instead of going the rude arsehole route, goes the creep route instead, asking if he can feel up Nahani. Next to the son's room is a chest I can't open as a pebble is lodged in the keyhole. I have to try opening it 4 or 5 times to get the pebble loose and open it for the living toy Baron. This turns 10% of my damage into money. I never use this one. And just in case the governor's wife seemed like the nice one of the family in comparison, we can go into the cellar and find she's so scary that a servant hides from her down there. I leave and watch this NPC get stuck against the stairs for a bit. I go south to the docks and inspect this cannon to find a tower shield lodged inside, 1 point over the iron shield. On the east side of the docks is a chest with the living toy minicar inside. This one just rams into a single enemy to knock it out of the battle. I can also check out one of the crates next to it for another bug. In a house slightly east of the governor's, there's a man in the basement planning world domination while staring at his wall. The next house east, we can get a little bit of backstory by inspecting some building blocks, where we learn that Nahani has been with Knight since he was young enough to be playing with them. There's also a mine berry in the blocks. I go east some more until I see an armourer, then enter the house across the street from it. I inspect the potted plant for another bug, and then again for another, and once again. This plant is a source of infinite bugs, and I just stand there mashing X until Knight's bag is full and I can make Baby very happy feeding him like 7 or 8 bugs at once. And since I'm maxing out all items, I start mashing X for even longer and sticking all the bugs into Baby's inventory. 15 minutes later, baby holds 99 bugs because I haven't found out the cap is 100 yet. I check out the armorer and spend 1250 rubies on an elven sword, 6 points stronger than the buccaneer sword. Then 600 goes towards a viking shield, 3 points stronger than the tower shield. That's wiped out my funds. In the northeast corner of town is a house with believers in a being called Artema, who also tried to convert Knight to their religion. The believer upstairs gives me the living toy vampire. This damages both the party and the enemies by 10% of their maximum health every turn. This sounds like a good way to get yourself killed, so I won't be using it. Searching this specific corner of the sofa will also get me an apple. West of that house is a cafe. Inside I can play the piano badly to make customers throw apples at me. Like the plant, this piano is a source of infinite apples, but I just get the one for now. Back in the Artema believer's house, there was an entire hidden church I missed. I can then take another door into a connected house. Hidden in the empty spot of this bookshelf is the living toy heal bat. It heals you by the amount of damage it deals to the enemy. In one of the side streets in the northwest is this house. Upstairs I talk to the guy living there who says he got a cactus in the desert near Kuldo, but inspecting it has it turned out to be fake. After getting lost for a while and running in circles, I finally find the ticket office, just next to the cannon in the southwest corner of town. Bonnick's already there, having already made the money to open his own shop in Jungo by selling all his jewels to the governor. He then sets off while singing. But he also just bought the last ticket. Who would have thought letting our friend die back in Easton would have made things easier for us? I go back to the cafe and listen in on a conversation about the governor looking for another gem, an emerald protected by the Beast of Kuldo. Anyone who brings it to him can have anything they want from him. Talking to the governor has him confirm this. Going back to the docks to see a new group of three standing there. There's the old man, Gwynladin, who thinks we're here to carry their bags. The healer, Ramal, who quickly loses her temper with Nahani for simply correcting him. Finally the knight, Kalkanor, who has no time for picking fights and just wants the emerald from Kuldo. They leave, but Nahani notices that something about them unnerves Baby, making him shake. Well, now it looks like I have competition. So of course I spend time grinding. Back in the desert, Knight reaches level 17. I face a new enemy, Sandworm. It takes a few hits from both of them to kill it. Killing it gets Baby to level 15. A few more fights later and he's level 16. The next fight gets Knight to level 18. 7 minutes later, Baby is level 17. With that grind done, I head to the southwestern corner of the desert. It's quite a trek and I have to check maps many times to make sure I'm going the right way, but eventually I find a cave entrance. I talk to the old man inside, Rogo. He thinks I'm someone else and tells me to deliver a stone slate to Gallic in the town Carmarthen. He doesn't listen when Nahani tries to explain we're not this Jedro, so we just do it for him. I inspect the dirt across from him to find snoozeweed. Then I check out the crates next to his house for a strange bug, which is a separate item to the regular bug. I then just continue south and out of the cave on the other side. I get following the road south. First battle gets a new enemy, Mantis. The next battle gets an important one, Psycho Cat. Killing it teaches Baby how to transform into it in battle, which he will at random if his happiness is the right level. Baby also gained an Ikbee transformation when I fought her back in Eastern. There's only a small amount of transformations compared to the amount of enemies in this game, so getting them all isn't too hard. The next battle after this gets Knight to level 19. Following the road east a little more takes me to some stairs leading into the mining town Carmarthen. One of the citizens tells me that Kalkanor has already passed by here on his way to Kuldo. Checking out the weapon shop, I spend 1900 rubies on the dwarf sword, 3 points stronger than the elven sword, and there goes most of my money once again. After resting at the inn, I leave town and grind for money, getting Baby to level 18. Then 4 minutes for Knight to reach level 20, Baby to level 19 a battle later. I build up 2100 rupees for some Roman armour, 13 points stronger than buccaneer mail, then back to the grind. 8 minutes later, Baby reaches level 20. 3 minutes after that, Knight reaches level 21. 9 minutes later, Baby also reaches level 21. I build up another 2150 rubies for Azusa shield, 8 more points over the Viking shield. I check out the house south of the inn, belonging to the mayor. It seems the title of mayor is passed on to the next of kin, as this woman became mayor after the previous one, her husband, died in a cave-in. Nearby, a woman tells me that Kuldo is the ruins past a swamp to the west of town. Past her, I can keep moving southwest along the cliff until I find a lone house hidden away. I try to enter, and Nahani says that it must be Gallic's house, but he isn't home. Back into town, and to the east is the entrance to the coal mine. I go inside and keep moving east, and first south turn I see leads to a chest with the living toy miner. When used in battle, it just attacks with an axe. When used outside, it mines for money. Going back east, I take the first north and inspect a minecart for a bone shield. It's weaker than my Zeus's shield, though. That's all I can do in this town for now, so I leave down the stairs and get following the road leading southwest. It soon leads into the swamp mentioned earlier. My first battle gets two new enemies to appear, Fatal Frog and Triad. The triad inflicts terror on both my characters, leaving them too afraid to fight. But living toys aren't affected, so I just ram it out of the fight with Minicar. Baby learns the fatal frog transformation. This place is a bit of a maze, so I start by going southwest some more across a bridge, then west across two more. South across a bridge, northwest along another, Knight reaches level 22. Then east and north across two more bridges, northwest across another, then west across one. Here I faced my first Fangfish. Here we can see the difference being able to equip armor makes, as Knight only takes 9 damage from an attack that deals 40 to Baby. I then go south across a bridge and then west across another. And finally, south, east, south and west across 4 more bridges to reach the entrance to Koldo. There's a merchant there who offers to watch over me while I sleep so that I can heal and save before I go in. The first room is a straight line south. In the next room I start by turning east. My first battle here is against a new enemy, Nightless. Pretty basic, can attack both characters at once. Hidden behind the camera against the wall is a chest containing a peach potion. I then turn around and move west, finding another chest with the living toy Psycho Dog. This one converts 20 HP from Knight into 10 PP for the cost of 2 PP, so you're only really gaining 8. Following the western path has me face the strongest enemy yet, Doorface. This one can even do decent damage to Knight. At the end of the path is stairs going up to this winding corridor. Near the end of this path is a chest that gets me the living toy Foreman. This one is an instant warp to the dungeon entrance, so it's very useful. But it also triggers a battle against a mimic. Just in case this is a pain, I summon Pyro, who deals the finishing blow by dealing my first attack to do triple digit damage. It also levels Baby up to 22. North of that chest is another with a candy bar, and south of it is another with a second. Then west of it is a door to a room with some stairs where there's a fork. I first go south into a room with a chest containing Koldian armor. This one is also a downgrade from the Roman armor I grinded for. Going north of the fork takes me to a higher level of the mimic room. This leads to two more chests for two living toys, Freud and Clarissa. Clarissa heals me a little every turn, like Final Fantasy's regen spell. Freud puts a single enemy to sleep. With the west wing cleared out, I leave to heal with the merchant. So this time I check out the east wing, which goes downstairs instead of up. The next room is just down more stairs and then east into another, where we're deep enough for there to be lava pits. The first enemy I face in here is a boomder, just a general fire enemy. Killing it gets Knight to level 23. I head to the centre of the room and then south to find the entrance to another. I then pretty much do the same thing for that room, leading to a chest containing the living toy Angel. It gives a stronger heal than Kimoni but costs more PP. I go back to the previous room and move west across this rock bridge. Then at the end I go north to find a chest containing a cheeseburger. Then it's back south and west some more to the next room. I go up the stairs and west across another bridge to another room. In here I face the largest regular enemy so far, the Crimshaw. I'm treating this one like a boss, so I summon Pyro and O'Neill to help me out. Despite that, he doesn't do as much damage as I was expecting. Nahani also uses her Pixie Dust skill, which is a small heal to both characters. I admit I was disappointed to not level up from killing it. I follow this room's winding path all the way, with Baby reaching level 23 during it. It leads to a chest containing a cheeseburger and the door to the next screen. I first turn west to grab the chest containing a Sword of Might, still weaker than my dwarf sword. I then continue south into an even larger room, where Nahani points out the trio we met in Zed Harbour. We get to watch them in an automated battle with the dungeon boss. We can see how far above us Kalkanor is when his normal attack deals over 240 damage. In the end, he's defeated in only 3 hits. As they take the emerald, Gwynladin says they have only 3 more to find. Kalkanor says they are a step closer to world peace and that they need to get going again quickly so that they can stop someone called Carmine. They leave, only stopping so Kalkanor can tell us we were too late. Nahani says all we can do is go back to Carmarthen to see if Gallic is home, then return to Zed Harbour to work something out. First I talk to the winged lion they defeated, who gets angry at us and attacks. This boss has 392 HP. As is usual for bosses, I start by sending out Pyro. It uses the attack Meteor, which for how destructive the animation is, does a lot less damage than I was expecting. About 4 turns is all it takes for the 3 of us to beat it down. Defeating it gets us the White Shield, a point stronger than Zeus's shield. With everything collected here, I leave and get moving back to Carmarthen. On the way back, Knight reaches level 24. That's all until I get back to Carmarthen, and this time I can enter Gallic's house. I talk to him to hand over the stone slate. He has his own artifact and slots the 2 together to create a warp gate key. Warp gates are large tunnels that connect many places in the world. We saw one after leaving Kell into the second half of the Cave of Fear. However, even when put together, this key is still broken. Gallic sees a small slot on the key for something extra, but he has no idea what goes in it. I go east into his lab and then up the stairs into the attic to find a talking treasure chest that gives me a spinach snack. Despite the chest's warning that it will self-destruct, it doesn't. With all that done, it's time to go back to Zed Harbour. Backtracking through the desert, I find an enemy I missed the first time, the Tau Tau. But by now I'm so far above it, it's no threat. Nothing else happens on the way back. Before seeing the governor, I go back into the cafe and mash X against the piano for an infinite supply of apples. 10 minutes later, I have 100, and I also get 100th bug from that one plant. So there's my first two item counts maxed out. I return to the governor's office where he's begging Kalkanor's group for the emerald. Kalkanor says he can't have it, as it is a holy gem to be used in saving the world. Nahani has Nightshade of a heavy stone he found in the Gale Stork's nest. Kalkanor offers to pay any price in exchange for it. Nahani says we just need tickets for the ship, and Kalkanor gladly accepts the trade. The trio are very grateful, the governor is not. But the ship will have to wait for next episode, as I'm leaving it here. For such a simple game, I was having a lot of fun with this. It helps that things actually move at a fast pace. Dungeons aren't too long, and neither is the travel to the next important location. At no point so far has any part of the game felt like a slog. Next episode will finally leave the continent and get a bit more freedom, so look forward to it. Exactly 10 episodes after the last time this happened, the last game of one episode becomes the first game of the next, with me continuing Guardian's Crusade. Last time we just got tickets for a ship out of Zed Harbor to the eastern continent in exchange for giving Kalkanor an important heavy stone. I go to the docks and hand over the tickets to be let on board the Zephyr. First thing I do is go up into the captain's cabin and inspect his phonograph. Nahani finds something next to it and the captain lets us have it, it's just a toadstool. Talking to him normally just has him reassure Nai that there's nothing to be afraid of with sea travel, except for falling overboard. Back outside, I go below deck. Nahani is exhausted and we automatically go to our cabin to rest. While inside, the ship sets sail and Nahani wonders what Jungo is like. We go to sleep and after waking, we get to explore more of the Zephyr. In one of the cabins, we meet it with Darkbeat and Ikbee again. Despite him completely destroying me in our fight back in Istan, he says it was the toughest fight he's had in a while. We learn that he's a mercenary so that he can support some group of people, but he refuses to elaborate. Nahani asks if Ikbee is a dinosaur or a walrus, to which Darkbeat replies that she's actually his little sister. It's clearly a sore point for them, and when Nahani gets Darkbeat to tell us their story, Ikbee stops him. I can go further downstairs into the storeroom to find a chest containing a peach potion. From one of the sacks, I can take an apple. There's a dining room where a traveller tells me an evil dragon was confined to God's Tower ages ago. Going back up on the deck, I can chat with Bonnick, who's thrilled to finally be able to open his own shop. Talking to the captain again just has him very aggressively ask if I've ever seen a coconut. Now I've walked around the entire ship, it's time to sleep again. We're woken up with the news that the ship has docked at Jungo, so we get off. This isn't the eastern continent, but we have some time to explore before the Zephyr sets off for Triskan. First thing I do is enter the shop and spend 3,300 rubies on a fire sword, 5 points stronger than my dwarf sword. South of the shop is a talking penguin person, who found a toy but doesn't want it, so he gives me the living toy Ringsider. Apparently this one just offers commentary? I don't know, the description's vague and I never used it. He's travelling too. Ikbee once visited his village far to the north and he asked her to take him with her. He also says that Darkbeat has invited us to visit him, since he lives here. The woman next to him says Ikbee has taken in many children and cares for them as if she was their own mother. Behind them, I can talk with Bonnick, taking in the fact that after years of work, he finally has his own shop. It was a dream his father had too, but he never lived to fulfill it. Darkbeat and Ikbee's house is around the centre of the town. Here we can see all the kids Ikbee takes care of. One of them she adopted after her parents were indoctrinated into a cult in the town Garum. Another one says it was the Artema cult, one we briefly met some worshippers of in Zed Harbor. Next to him, I can try stealing one of Darkbeat's swords, only for Nahai to say he'll kill me and make me put it back. We can see Ikbee either reading a book to some kids or holding a pot of food, I can't quite make it out. Darkbeat is in the basement. He repeats that most of these kids have had their parents taken in by the Artema cult, making them almost like orphans. And since he and Ikbee were orphans, they wanted to take care of them. That's why he does the mercenary job. He says that Carmine will pay for this. Carmine is also the name we heard Kalkanor mention last time, the person he wants to save the world from. Well, Darkbeat and Kalkanor seem strong enough to deal with that, so we'll be fine to just deal with our own quest. Darkbeat's also writing his autobiography, referring to himself as a chosen one. I go west and into the house directly across from Darkbeat's and inspect the plant to gain 5 bugs all get better baby since I already had the full 100. On the west side of town, we get to watch a traveller from the ship be reunited with his wife, and then immediately ask if she got fat while he was gone. She has good news for him and tells him inside. I enter their house where, as everyone's expecting, the good news is that she's pregnant. Neither of them can think of a name, so he makes the worst decision of his life. He asks me, the person who hates naming things. For his foolishness, I name his unborn son, Dickhead. Only 7 characters, so I had to drop the A. He proudly yells, "Our son will be named Dickhead." To thank me for my help, he gives me the living toy Ditchmobile, which increases my agility for a few turns. I go to the inn and find that the innkeeper was also spying on the couple to relive her own youth. In the south at the town's exit, I can have baby play in a fountain to cool down. In the house opposite the fountain, I go into the basement and inspect a box for a bug. There's a cafe, but baby isn't allowed in and there's no items inside, so I'm not leaving him out on his own for no reason. I leave the town through that southern exit. Jungo is on a small island, so there isn't too much to explore. One guy recommends I follow the path to the lighthouse and back for the exercise. I get moving southeast and in my first battle, finally see baby transform. This time into his fatal frog form, getting all its attacks. The new enemy I face is a Zacra, and it turns out I misremembered two enemies at once being the limit as there are three here. Killing them also teaches baby a Zacra transformation. My next battle is against my first palette swapped enemy, the Dino Rex, a stronger dino. They have quite a large amount of HP, taking 4 hits each to kill. Baby reaches level 24. At the end of the path, I cross a bridge and reach the lighthouse. I run up several sets of stairs to the top and find a chest with the living toy Miyama inside, which temporarily increases defense. Inspecting one of the lamps along the stairs gets me a strange bug. That's all for the lighthouse, so I head back the way I came. In my first battle, I get to see baby's Zacra transformation. It's a bit unnerving with the one baby eye you can see. I buy a 3300 ruby fire armor for 4 extra points of defense over the Roman armor. After resting, I leave town again and take the southwest path. When the path splits, I go south and find some ruins. These are another warp gate I can't use. That's pretty much all there is to explore on this island, so time for a small grind. Another new enemy around here, the Stingbird. Knight reaches level 25. I get to see baby's Psycho Cat transformation. On the beach, I face my first Crabera. Nothing remarkable, but killing it gets baby to level 25. Baby uses his Ikbee transformation a few minutes later. This one is very powerful, as you'd expect. 8 minutes later, Knight reaches level 26. I soon have the money to buy a 3300 ruby fire shield for 3 more defense over the white shield. That's all for this island, so I get back on the Zephyr after keeping everyone else waiting so long. We stay in the cabin, and most passengers we talk to are either seasick or just complaining about the rocking of the ship. I go up onto the deck and see if it is pissing it down. That explains the rocking. There's a chest containing one of the few missable living toys, Terroroid, which inflicts terror on an enemy. A sailor reminds me that we're on our way to Triskan on the eastern continent. I go talk to the captain, who's absolutely giddy at being caught in a storm. Running about below deck some more, and baby starts getting seasick too. Nihani suggests we take him above deck for some fresh air. This turns out to be a bad idea, as the storm gets worse and we see some kind of giant sea serpent. The ship rocks hard enough to throw us overboard. Nihani wakes Knight up after he washes up on a beach, but baby is missing. I start looking by heading west into a forest and eventually finding a small village, Kerpel. I head to the middle of the village to find the Kerpelans have baby. They intend to sacrifice baby to please the evil god Ugonga, who they believe will kill them otherwise. I check out the house in the northeast and get stuck between the Kerpelan and some jars. Luckily, this guy offers me a free rest, which spawns me in a different spot after the save so I don't have to reset. In the house east of the middle, I can steal a bean from a jar. The Kerpelan in there says that Ugonga lives in the shrine in the north of the village. In the house south of that one, I can have Knight accidentally drink some glue. Next to it is the chief's hut. I take some money from a barrel and open the chest for the living toy Mudzi, which decreases an enemy's agility. The chief reiterates that they need to sacrifice or Ugonga will kill them, so it looks like I'm gonna kill Ugonga for them. West of the chief's hut is a small girl who feels bad about this. She was supposed to be the sacrifice till baby washed up and they substituted her for him. In the hut north of that is a man who had to sacrifice his wife to Ugonga, leaving his son without a mother. Before taking on the shrine, I do a little grind on the beach in case Knight alone isn't strong enough. The first battle is against a wasp. It has the standard abilities you'd expect of a wasp, stinging you to poison you, firing lasers, taking 3 sword strikes to kill. Next is the flower eye, with a permanent expression as if it's asking for death. Even without the XP split and shared between 2 characters, it still takes 15 minutes for Knight to reach level 27. My next battle is against a strong new enemy, the Rose Devil. This becomes the first enemy in the game to actually poison me. And poison does a huge amount of damage, more than the monster's actual attacks. Luckily, all status effects wear off at the end of the battle. 13 minutes after my last level up, Knight reaches level 28. I decide this is enough and enter that shrine in the north of the village. The first room is just a straight line north. In the second, I get this place's first new enemy, the Cursey. The second room has a couple turns but is still very straightforward. The third room starts by giving me a chest containing the living toy Pipanic, which confuses an enemy. I go east down a slope and find a second chest with some crystal armour inside. My fire armour is stronger though. I then go south into the fourth room. Right away, there's a chest with a cheeseburger. I go east across a narrow bridge and south to a chest. Now that I'm used to having Baby around to carry all my items, having to empty my inventory when it gets full is a little annoying. All for a peach potion. Then it's north into the fifth room. In here, I find Ugonga and take him on. Ugonga has 610 HP. First thing I do is bring out my good buddy Pyro, and on my second turn I bring out Clerisy for regular healing. His attacks only do around 30 to 40 damage, and since he's the only opponent in this battle, that makes him easily manageable. He goes down in a few turns, with Pyro dealing the final blow. Ugonga's dead, but there's still a bit more to do in here. I go east into another room where there's a chest containing a crystal shield. Once again, weaker than my fire shield. South of that is a second chest with the living toy Hobo Joe, who steals items from an enemy. This is never really useful, as there isn't much worth stealing. This triggers a mimic battle, but they're easily dealt with by now. That's everything in here, so I use Foreman to exit. I'm greeted at the entrance by a Kerplin. Thankful for us freeing them from Ugonga and the need to sacrifice, they release Baby to us. We get to watch their celebratory dance, which is just their walking animation. The chief asks what reward we would like, and the Nahani says we need a boat, since we're stuck on this small island. They don't have boats, but they do have Chester. I go to his hut and he gives me the Chester flute, telling me to use it at any body of water. Nahani has no idea what he's talking about. I can also now enter the storeroom in the northeast of the village. It has a chest with the living toy Samurai. This one returns any active living toys to my inventory and then uses an attack of its own. Examining the small box in here gets me an apple. I return to the beach and fight a jellyfish man. This is important because this is another transformation for Baby. These were around between Orgo and San Claria, but Baby was never in the party during this and couldn't learn it. I use the Chester flute to see what it's about. Chester is a giant water bug that I can ride across the ocean. I can only summon him and dismount at beaches, but this opens up a lot of new places. The only real downside is that the world is kind of big and he moves a little slow. Travelling large distances can take a while. I start by running along the western side of the western continent. While at sea, enemies are represented by pirate ships, which we fight on. My first sea battle gets me the Anemone enemy. After a few minutes of riding, I eventually reach the northwestern quarter of the continent and get off at the beach that I mentioned between Orgo and San Claria. I take out another Noigan for Baby's Noigan transformation. I accidentally mash through Baby reaching level 26 as I wasn't expecting a level up from such low XP. On Grave Road, I take out a Dino for the Dino transformation, and back in the Gale of Fear, I defeat a Snakera for the Snakera transformation. Finally, there's the Fat Bat for the Fat Bat transformation. Though for some reason, saving Baby at Kerpal does something to his happiness that prevents him from using any transformations unless you do things to mess about with the happiness value yourself. So we won't be seeing much of Baby's transformations for a while. They'll happen still, but they'll be very rare. I next travel to the southmost beach of the western continent. First enemy I face here is definitely the strangest so far, the Coacher. I don't think I've ever battled a carriage with a face before, especially how its punch is just smacking me with a wheel. Someone's been playing Fighters Mega Mix and thought, we can do that in our RPG. I find the nearest road and start following it northwest. The next Coacher I fight shows off a unique ability, hit and run, it'll just charge through us and escape the fight. The path eventually leads to a new town, Den Heldar. This is one of the simplest towns so far, as all the buildings form a square. I check out the door in the southwest corner, but the inhabitant won't let me in and throws a living toy at my head. I gain Insectafly, which reduces an enemy's defense. Next to it is the weapon shop where I buy the 4700 ruby Kuldian sword, 4 points stronger than my fire sword. And for the same price, Kuldian armor, 4 points stronger than the fire armor. 1250 rubies get me the Viking helmet, 1 point stronger than my iron helmet, and for another 4700 for the Kuldian shield, 4 points stronger than the fire shield. I next check out the house in the northwest corner, where the mayor's daughter, Gamella, says the mayor is missing. She believes he's being held captive at the north tower. She says a man with a yellow dinosaur also came by and went to the tower, clearly meaning Darkbee and Ikbee, but they're not back either. In the next house going east, I can inspect the fireplace to find one ruby. I go into the inn, where the innkeeper says he had a guest, a watchmaker from Triskan, who also went off to the North Tower and hasn't come back. That's all for now. To me, the most notable thing about the town is that its music was remixed for the ugly, incomprehensible demo video that played if you left the title screen for a while. Said remix I found quite annoying to listen to. I leave town through the east exit and have a little grind, Knight reaching level 29 from my first battle. A few battles later, Baby reaches level 27. In the end, it took 20 minutes for Baby to reach level 28, then the next battle gets Knight to level 30. Another 20 minutes for Baby to reach level 29. Even an hour into this grind at the same area, I'm still getting new enemies. In this case, it's the Ramble. It takes 12 minutes for Knight to reach level 31. Now it's time to take on that North Tower. From Den Helder's east exit, I follow the road southeast. Then when I reach a faraway fork, I go north. The long road starts going northwest until I eventually reach the North Tower. Right away, I go south into another room. This is a big room, but first I go east into a smaller room for a chest with a crystal sword. I then go west into another small room where the chest has the living toy Donor, which reduces enemy attack and defense. Back in the main room, I go west to the wall and south all the way to find another little room. The chest in here gets me a devil shield. My habit of buying the strongest equipment at new towns always makes the ones I find in chests obsolete immediately. I then get heading to the room's southeast corner, facing my first buffu on the way. Its thunderbolt attack causes the first instance of paralysis in this playthrough. It's also one of Baby's transformations, as I learn when I kill it. There's another room in the southeast corner that gets me the living toy Tough Wall. It takes a few turns protecting one of my party from any damage. I then head to the centre of the room where there's a pillar and get moving south. I face my first big roaches, who start the battle poisoning us both. That's when I learn that Nahani's pixie dust also cures poison. In the centre south of the room is the doorway to the next. I go up two flights of stairs to the next screen, which is two more sets of stairs, and then another two. Next room is the pillar and more stairs. At the top of the stairs is a doorway leading outside. Nahani is confused as to where these supposed missing people are, and decides they aren't here and we should head back. First, there's a chest in the southwest corner containing the living toy Vegas. It does something with my luck stat, but the menu description doesn't help at all. There's another chest in the northeast corner with some splint mail inside. Once again, obsolete. I trek back down to the first floor and see a blue demon walking off into a secret room. I follow it into this long tunnel that goes downstairs and into the next screen. Then it's even more stairs down. Through the next doorway, I run into Darkbee and Ikbee. Ikbee tells Nahani that the missing townspeople are in the next room. Darkbee's fine with us helping, but tells us to stay out of his way before they move on. Before following, I grab this chest for the living toy Mossman, which reduces an enemy's attacking power. I then follow Darkbee into the next room to see him confront the blue monster along with the red one. They're working for Carmine and are ready to kill us for interfering. Darkbee and Ikbee will face the red one, so I get the blue one, and most of his body changes colours during the battle transition. The blue monster has 820 HP. I start by bringing out Tough Wall and having it protect Baby. Its missile gun does around 40 damage to Knight, but since Baby's protected, I don't get to see what it does with no armour. I also bring out good buddy Pyro. It tries a jet punch, but once again hits Tough Wall. After that, we just beat it down, since after its first turn, it only ever ends up attacking my living toys. This battle also gets Baby to level 30. Darkbee also took out his monster, and we freed the captives. Darkbee heads off back to Den Helder to collect the reward. The mayor and two others thank me and leave, but the last one says that the guy from Triskan is still deeper in the tower. So I head south into the next room where there's some kind of teleporter I stand on. Why would you even willingly come through here? To no one's surprise, he's being attacked. The Guardian simply asks if I'm worthy before the battle begins. The Guardian has 1050 HP. Same setup as before, Tough Wall on Baby. Once again, it keeps aiming its attacks at the protected Baby. This time, I bring out the bomb for the first time since the Galestalk fight. Its burst shot is a tough move, as it deals over 60 damage to Knight and hits the entire party. After the second burst shot, I get my first instance of Baby healing himself. I didn't think things through with the bomb, as he's so powerful his explosion takes out Tough Wall and does massive damage to Baby, who is then attacked and left with just 21 HP. So I bring out Clarissa to keep him alive, and then Pyro to replace the bomb. Pyro is the one to get the killing blow. The Guardian leaves behind a chest that grants me a Solomon's Ring. Now I could summon Doomtrain with 6 Melbro Tentacles, 6 Remedy Pluses and 6 Steel Pipes, but none of those exist in this game. Nahani says fairies use it for something, then refuses to elaborate and drops the subject. The man from Triskan thanks me and says that he was sent here by Kalkanor to find a gem, but it looks like there isn't one here, so he leaves to report to him. He introduces himself as Jeddik before he goes, saying I should visit if I'm ever in Triskan so he can give me a present as thanks. It's time for me to leave as well. My first battle outside is against another new one, Cockatrice. It paralyzes me on its first turn and causes Baby's first death in this playthrough, along with my first time running, since I don't want to have to repeat that entire dungeon. I then just avoid all fights on the way back to Den Helder so I can heal and, more importantly, save. I also spend 9,980 rubies on a Cobra Ring to make Knight immune to poison. Accessories cost an insane amount in this game. Back in the mayor's house, Gamella is incredibly grateful for us getting her dad home. The mayor gives me a family heirloom, the living toy Windmeister, which performs a wind elemental attack to a single enemy. That's it for Den Helder, but I decide to have a short 8-minute grind before moving on. Knight reaches level 32, and Baby reaches level 31. I go back near the North Tower to take out a Cockatrice and get my revenge. At the nearby beach I call Chester. there's this island southwest of Argo Village I want to check out. I get off at the one beach and follow the road southwest until it turns north, leading to a house. The mailbox lets me know that this is the Zepetto family house on Zepetto Island. O'Neill mentioned Professor Zepetto before, as the one who created the living toys. And when we go inside, we can see loads of broken and unfinished toys strewn about the place. There's also this music, and I don't know how to describe it. I'm not good with talking about music. It sounds very cozy and nice at first, but there's also this sadness behind it that stood out to me, though I'll get into that more in the next episode. I can go upstairs into a bedroom where there's an old man. Talking to him has O'Neill jump out of us and confirm this is Professor Zepetto. He asks if Zepetto remembers making him, saying it was over 100 years ago. He says he is actually Zepetto Jr., the grandson of the professor. He came to this island to finish his grandfather's work. He's glad to learn that the living toys have been helpful to us, saying it would make his late grandfather very happy. I can also inspect his cabinet for the Zepetto helmet. This is a huge 38-point increase over the Viking helmet. That's all we can do here right now, so I get going. At this point, I get a bit aimless. Knowing that Zed Harbor's shops will close at some point has me thinking that maybe I should grind out the money now to buy 100 of all the items just in case they close sooner than I am expecting. I spend just about all my money buying 100 steel swords, getting me my third maxed out item. There's an island northeast of this town that I hear has some stronger enemies, so I hope to get good money from them. On the way to said island, I face my first Shellyod and Hogfish enemies. Even these are quite strong. 2 battles later, I get a pair of Serpentines. These are also quite strong right now and can paralyze. After a long trek, I reach this island. The first new enemy I find is the Crappiefish. These can do over 60 damage to baby, so I have to be careful. But on the other side, the Crappiefish is another of baby's obtainable transformations. About 10 minutes on this island has baby reached level 32, and a couple more battles get knight to level 33. But then I realise how impractical this is and decide to just move on with the plot. I return to Easton. I check out Richton's house to find he ran away after the election, and as far as I'm aware, he's just gone from the game, we never see him again. It seems like the Artema cult has spread to Easton as well, as at least one guy is here preaching his wisdom. I enter the church to find that Marco has disappeared, being the third from this town alone to do so. There's another Artema follower blocking access to one of the houses, but Nahani isn't standing for any of that and demands they free Marco. I push her aside but run around town a bit more, inspecting this barrel outside the cafe for a terror seed. I go into the inn and check out the clock for a candy bar to fall out. I finally enter the building the follower was blocking. There's a gargoyle blocking my entry into the rest of the temple. He has 500 HP and I do the usual tough wall and pyro, then very easily beat it down. Well, that was easy and Marco is saved. Cartman shows up to check on him and is incredibly thankful for our help. Now they can finally have their wedding. Marco thinks the wedding is still weeks away, but that's because he's been kept in some kind of trance for a while and hasn't realised how long it's been. The wedding's tomorrow, and we cut to the next morning where it's underway. Since we woke up late, we accidentally turn up right after the mayor asks if there are any objections, but everyone laughs it off. We creepily follow behind the couple as they stop to be congratulated by everyone on their way home. Though I do wonder if Marco and Carmen even like these people, as their thanks for the compliments come off rather, please leave me alone, but maybe that's just me. They go inside the cafe and we just get to watch the outside of the building and see people celebrating in text box form. It goes on for a while, seeing people show up late and buying drinks, but there isn't much to say about it, so let's skip ahead. Knight accidentally drinks booze instead of juice and passes out, some nameless villager being stuck carrying him to the inn. The next morning I go to Marco's house and we get one of the consequences of the hero's canon name being Knight. Thank you for taking part in our wedding, Knight. Carmen gives me the living toy Marilyn, which grants a full heal for 20 PP. This is one that just gets better and better as I level up and get more PP to use it and more HP to heal by while the cost stays the same. The Artema cult is still allowed to operate here for some reason, as the follower outside tries to deny any of what they've been doing. I go upstairs in the temple and find a rotten weed in a jar. And with that, I leave Easton once again. I next return to the Coastal Inn. There's now a chest I can open containing the living toy Wime, which acts as a decoy and draws all enemy attacks to it. Then it's back to riding Chester on the ocean. I start heading directly south from Zed Harbour. Eventually, I reach a beach on the southwestern corner of the Eastern Continent. We finally got here after a million distractions. I head east and find an abandoned house with a chest outside. This has the living toy Stare, which outside of battles gives a top-down view of my location, and in battle attacks with an eye laser. It also triggers a mimic fight. At this point I don't even need the living toys, I can just beat them down. The house is a bit sinister. Flowers and knockers out and messages written in blood, but there's nothing to do here. I just go outside and get following the path north and across a bridge. My first battle is against a Theodon, and what the hell is its mouth? Despite the size, it isn't that much of a threat. My next battle is against the Bobo Dragon, which is about the same level of strength. This one turns out to be another of Baby's transformations. The path starts turning east and Baby reaches level 33. Continuing east, I finally reach the city Triskan. There's a recruiter at the gate asking if I want to join the Royal Guard. I say yes to start a test battle. This toy knight has just 280 HP, so it goes down in no time. However, Knight is too young to join the Royal Guard. To make up for it, he gives me the living toy Dr. Snooze, which puts all enemies to sleep. There's several tourists dotted around who are all lost because the tour guide is shit at their job. Four houses east from the west entrance and I find Jadik's house and can meet his wife, Maris. Talking to Jadik has him thank me with the living toy Tarantula, which poisons all enemies. I talk to a guy outside the house who asks me if I dropped this wallet. We take it with the intention to return it to its owner. Nearby is a bell tower I can enter. I climb up several sets of stairs to find a chest getting me the living toy Sacrobat. I can use it when there's another active living toy to return it to me in exchange for damaging all enemies. I can then go up one more floor to ring the bells, but it doesn't do anything special. Across from the bell tower is a girl selling flowers. I can buy a red rose for 300 rubies so that her boss doesn't yell at her today. He also gets Knight flirted with a bit. Next to the flower shop is the monster training gym. Inside I can beat up a punching bag to knock a hamburger out of it. This is for training Baby. I pay to battle monsters that are always set to a higher level than Baby, and if he wins, he gains stats. The issue is, it's just not very useful. The fights are slow, completely AI controlled, and a single fight costs Baby's level multiplied by 100 rubies, and that's all for one stat point increase. And it's random. The guide I was using said each monster increased a specific stat, but that's just not how it went for me. I had the same enemy increase a different stat each time. I don't know if the guide was mistaken or if it's a change to the PAL version or what. Also, Baby loses the first fight because he isn't automatically healed at the start of the battle, meaning multiple consecutive fights will need a trip to the inn between each one. As I explore some more, I learn that there's a party at the castle that Kalkanor is attending. South of him, a woman says that one of the Atema cultists has returned home, but his daughter is still being looked after by Ikbee. Next to her, I check this box for some sickweed. East of her is a house where I can go upstairs and find a bug in the barrel in the corner. I check out the armourer and spend 8300 rubies on a demon sword, 8 points stronger than my Kuldian sword. Another 8300 goes to the leopard armour, 8 points over the Kuldian armour. And 8300 once again for the leopard shield, also 8 points stronger than the Kuldian shield. I don't need to buy new helmets for a long time though, since the Sepeto helmet is so good. South a little and west along the street, I find the guy who lost the wallet and return it to him. He thanks me with 1000 rubies. South of him is the weapon shop, and inspecting the sign gets me a freedom root. There's a guy at the pier who forgot his fishing rod, then realises he also forgot to bring his wife. When Nahana grills him over which he cares about more, he doesn't know the correct answer. In the southeast corner of town, I can have a couple ask me to take a picture for them. You get nothing for doing it, but it's a nice thing to do, isn't it? Just don't ask me to do it in real life. Finally, I can enter the castle to the south of town, as it's open to the public. I can stare at a couple in the west of the courtyard to creep them out and get the boyfriend to pay me 500 rubies to leave them alone. Do it again and he tries bribing me with 1000 next. Pushy luck a third time and he gets pissed off and takes all 1500 of it back. For some reason, I then get the idea to try training Baby again. I win 2 fights for 2 extra stats, moving on. I enter the castle. I get to see the king welcoming Kalkanor's group home and wanting to hear about their journey. Kalkanor and Ramal were a bit snappy when we first met, but now they're in a more relaxed setting, they're nicer to us. But a noblewoman near the king feels uneasy about Gwyn Ladin. And considering he gets pissed and calls me a meddling fool when he learns I saved Jadik, yeah, I'm gonna agree. I chat to a random noble for the noblewoman I just mentioned to say her purse has been stolen. Or as she says, somebody stolen. Kalkanor has the guards seal off the exit so no one can escape. Baby can sniff out the thief as the nobleman I just spoke to. When Kalkanor tries to inspect him, he runs off. I chase him up the stairs and have him at a dead end, but he runs past us down the opposite set of stairs. There, he's caught between all 4 of us. He decides he's going to at least take me down with him and starts a battle. He starts the fight by stealing an apple from me, that bitch. Unlucky for him, he has only 360 HP, so he goes down in no time. I take my apple back too. Just as the king is thanking us, Baby runs off on his own. I talk to the noblewoman who rewards me with a water ring, which reduces damage from fire attacks. Before I leave, I chat to Gwyn Ladin, who's still being a creep. Looking for Baby, I leave town through the east exit and follow the road to find Baby at another gate. Nahani asks why Baby ran away, but before she translates his answer, the King of Triskan shows up. He says that those gates are the edge of civilization, and that beyond it is the realm of monsters. Considering there are still 2 human towns past this point, that's a bit of a dick thing to say. Baby tries to say that he was born past that gate, meaning we're getting closer to God's Tower. Grateful for Baby's thief-sniffing skills, the king has the guards let us through. Now I can go through, I go north and get looking for fights. The only enemies in the eastern pass are the 650 HP Tartarus. With these, I use Dr. Snooze to put them to sleep. I'm taking no chances with them. They give over 2000 XP, so they're good for grinding right now. Killing my second one gets Knight to level 34. However, while managing my inventory, I do something stupid. I accidentally feed Baby the water ring, intending to make him store it. You can't buy these, so it seems it was the only one in the game, so I'm resetting. Off screen, I get back to where I was, but this time I don't feed Baby a rare item. It will turn out much later that I didn't need to reset, but I didn't know at the time. 5 minutes later, I get Baby to level 34. Then another 5 minutes for Knight to reach level 35. 6 more minutes for Baby to reach level 35. I once again waste money and time at the Monster Training Center, but only manage 4 battles before getting fed up. But then my next recording session, something happens without me noticing. Recently, I've been increasing the brightness on my Elgato and recording games through composite cables like PS1 and N64 games. Since, as can be seen in older videos, the footage usually comes out dark at default settings. For some reason, the Elgato decided to go back to the default brightness for a long time without me noticing, because it all looks the same on my TV. So from here through to pretty much the end of the third episode on this game, things won't look as nice. Sorry about that. Time to actually get through the Eastern Pass. I just keep following the road east. I know I'm out of the pass when I get a new enemy, the Cabra. This one doesn't get to do anything since I keep it asleep. I keep moving east and reach the next village, Garum. First thing I do is enter the shop and spend 9,900 rubies on an Onyx Sword to free more attack over my Demon Sword. Then 10,450 rubies on Onyx Armor for 4 more defense of the Leopard Armor. Then the same amount for an Onyx Shield for the same upgrade of the Leopard Shield. A guy of the north of the village says that the path to the next town, Denverado, and God's Tower by extension, has been blocked off by a landslide that he's still working on clearing out. I go into the mayor's house near the shop, who tells me that there's a giant in the cave to the east of town. There's a child called Anne still in that cave, but the mayor had to have the cave sealed off with her inside to prevent the giant from escaping and wreaking havoc on the village. I inspect one of the mayor's shelves to take a go-go bean. I then go up the western stairs and look through a sack of rice to find a bug. I try the next house to the east, which contains a Neugen farm, where they raise them for food. I try talking to one, only to find a hamburger underneath it. The house slightly to the south is Anne's, where her worrying mother prays for her safety. Looking at Anne's teddy bear gets me a rotten weed. With all the treasure collected, I leave to the east. Anne's father is there begging for anyone to save his daughter. The cave is further east. Right away to the west is a chest with the living toy Sumode, which does a physical attack to all enemies. The giant is in the back, just standing there immobile. In fact, Nahani thinks it's actually just a statue and the villagers are just wimps. That's when the giant wakes up and starts a battle. Ruval, as the giant is named, has 1240 HP. As usual, start with Tough Wall and Baby. Then the guide said to use Contributor. Wait, what? I don't have that one. Turns out I missed a chest all the way back in my first visit to Istan. So I just bring out Windmeister instead, since Ruval is Earth Elemental, I believe. I definitely need Tough Wall here, as even with great armor, Ruval's Earth Bomb does almost 100 damage to Knight, so who knows what it'll do to Baby. I make sure to set Clarissa to Knight to be on the safe side. Even then, Earth Bomb does more damage than Clarissa can heal each turn. He's also got the slightly weaker blaster move which hits the entire party, knocking out Windmeister. Then his Earth Bomb takes out Tough Wall and Clarissa at once. So out comes Reliable Pyro to fireball him in the nuts, which is the finishing blow. Knight reaches level 36 from this battle. Before we can kill him, Anne stops us, saying that Ruval is her friend. Ruval never held Anne prisoner, he was keeping her safe after the earthquake and landslide, and she couldn't get home because everyone else sealed her in trying to keep Ruval in. Anne and Ruval are close enough that Anne knows Ruval would never attack the town. Well, since that's sorted, I guess we can leave. Except, on the way out, Calcanora, Marl and Gwynladin show up. They walk right past us with the intent of killing Ruval. Nahani tries to explain the situation, but Ramal just apologises and stuns us, making us watch an automated battle between Gwynladin and Ruval. Gwynladin has the powerful Black Sphere attack that does around 250 damage and seemingly infinite health, just tanking everything Ruval throws at him. Calcanor takes the last of the sacred gems from Ruval, telling Knight that he'll understand what he had to do someday. As they go to leave, Knight regains control and challenges Calcanor. Like the battle with Darkbeat in Istan, we can't win this one. Calcanor is too powerful, one attack dealing over 400 damage to Baby, so I'm easily beaten down. Calcanor recognises Knight's efforts and respects him for it, but Ramal says that they need these gems to save the world before they set off for God's Tower. They just respond by saying they're only doing what they have to do to stop Carmine and the Artemical. Despite what happened, Raval still seems to be alive, just injured, as he still talks. This is one of those things I think the game doesn't explain well, as everyone is acting as if he's dead. I talk to Anne's father outside, letting him know his daughter is safe so he can go get her. Anne is crying over Ruval's death despite him not being dead as her father takes her home. Like, Ruval is still in the cave and can still be spoken to, so I'm just confused. But before I move on, I have a living toy I missed that I need to backtrack to. So I go back through the Eastern Pass, through Triskan, to the beach and take Chester all the way back to Istan. I just want to point out that it was a 13-minute journey, because travelling on Chester takes so long. I enter Richten's abandoned house and open a chest for the living toy contributor. For just 5pp, it throws 20 rubies at the enemy for huge damage. Then comes the long trek back to Garum. On my way back through the Eastern Pass, Baby reaches level 36. Back in Garum, I leave town to the north and get following the road. It seems the landslide was cleared as I can now enter the mountain road. The only enemy in this area is the Rock Viper. These I just don't mess around with and put them to sleep right away. The road keeps turning east and west all while still going north, with Knight reaching level 37 on the way. Eventually, it takes me to the snowy village Denvrado. At the gate is an old man who also travelled here looking for St. Aruvin's Sanctuary so he can get his disease cured. To the west, a woman is looking for her husband, a zombie. It's his dinner time, but now he's a zombie, he gets confused and forgets things more often. To the west is a singer, and if I accept his offer of a song, he sings about the saviour, Carmine. If I listen to the entire song, he'll sell me a record for 1,000 rubies. The record does nothing. It just exists to be in my inventory. More importantly, as a freebie, he gives me the living toy Hornet. This poisons a single enemy. To the south, I can find the zombie husband behind a house. I tell his wife where he is, but don't get any reward for it. At the north edge of the village against this cliff is Sean. Talking to him lets us see an FMV of the view, where we can finally see God's Tower in the distance. Sean has even seen the stork carrying Baby from the tower. In the northeast of town, there's a monk who's also looking for the zombie husband. It turns out that Aruvin guy somehow accidentally turned the guy into a zombie. The monk considers killing the zombie, but can't bring himself to since he hasn't done anything wrong. This changes the wife's dialogue about how she still loves her husband and doesn't care if he's rotting and smells now. At the village's western exit, a guard tells me I look sick and should see Aruvin about it. Well, as long as he doesn't turn me into a zombie. Aruvin's sanctuary is along this path out of the village, so I get going into the second half of the mountain road. There are still only rock vipers here. Once again, the path has twists and turns, but thanks to the mountains on either side of me, I can't get lost. During this journey, Baby reaches level 37. I eventually leave the mountains and within seconds get a new enemy, the Lyrebird. 720 HP these have, the most of any generic enemy so far. The path is still straightforward here, so I just keep going until the road ends. I keep heading north through some ruins and getting Knight to level 38. Soon after, I reach Aruvin's Sanctuary. The first person I speak to tells me that Kalkanor's group has already set off for God's Tower to face Artema. This person also grants me a free rest. Aruvin is in the back, meditating next to a book, 10 cool ways to sit with your legs crossed and float. I try talking to Aruvin, but he's very clearly sleeping, not meditating. He's also got a bright red suit of armour, but Nahani won't let me steal it. Not because it's wrong, but because she thinks he looks gaudy. East of the sanctuary, the land looks as if it's dying, but we're not going further this episode. Before closing off the game for this episode, let's get one more grind out of the way. The only new enemy here is the Octagug, whatever this is supposed to be. It even has more HP than the Lyrebird, but it do grant a nice 2600 XP though. It takes a couple minutes for Baby to reach level 38, but Lyrebirds turn out to be better to grind on. They have less HP but grant 600 more XP. Knight takes 9 more minutes to reach level 39, Baby joins him 3 minutes later. 7 minutes for Knight to reach level 40, 6 more to get Baby to that level. 6 more minutes for Knight to reach level 41, and just 5 minutes for Baby to hit 41 as well, and that's where I'm gonna leave it. I still have the same thoughts I did at the end of the last episode, with the only change being that the slow water bug does add some slight tediousness to the game, but otherwise I'm still invested and enjoying it. Next episode we finally take Baby home to God's Tower and find out what the deal with this Carmine guy is. And once again we start off an episode with Guardian's Crusade. Last time we ended things at the Holy Shrine, the last place to rest before God's Tower. I get going west to enter the swamp. I head all the way north and then west a little to find there's another warp gate here. Instead, I go east until I see normal land again, and then turn north to finally reach the bridge to God's Tower. Further ahead, Nahani sees Kalkanor, Ramal and Gwynladin confronting a guy with green hair and a red cape. This is Carmine. Kalkanor says that even if Carmine manages to unseal something called Shizan, they have all the holy stones so they can seal it back again. Kalkanor tells Gwynladin to arrest Carmine, but Gwynladin instead hands the holy stones over to Carmine. It turns out Gwynladin was working for Carmine from the beginning, and his real name is Glor. Yeah, I'd give myself a new name too. Ramal is furious, but Kalkanor is still confused until Carmine spells it out for him. Glor has tricked Kalkanor and Ramal into gathering all the stones for Carmine under the lie that doing so would save the world. Carmine has one last task for Glor, and this one Glor is not happy with. He removes Glor's intelligence and walks away as he transforms into a giant skeletal dragon. I get to watch a battle between him and Kalkanor. He starts with a fire breath dealing over 200 damage, while Kalkanor responds with an attack for similar damage. Glor then slashes Kalkanor with his claws for another 200. The two continue to trade attacks until Kalkanor falls over defeated. Next he targets Ramal. Ramal has spells to heal herself with, but Glor's attacks vastly outpace them. She goes down even quicker. Having watched the two who just defeated us back in Garen be taken out, Knight and Baby step up next. Glor has 1560 HP, and his only attacks are the Fire Breath and Claw Swipe we saw him use on Kalkanor and Ramal. I start with Tough Wall on Baby and then I bring out Contributor who deals over 250 damage. It seems Knight and Baby are tougher than Kalkanor and Ramal, as Glor's attacks don't even deal over 100 damage to them. I next bring out Windmeister and he's very quickly defeated, with Contributor getting the final blow. Seeing the state Kalkanor and Ramal are in, Nahana gets the idea to return to Arovin's Sanctuary and have him help. I return there to find that Arovin is now awake. Arovin already knows what has happened and has had his assistants pick them up and take them to Triskan to heal. When Nahani asks how he knows, he changes the subject and says he fears for the life of another holy creature. This news makes Baby try to run off alone again before Nahani stops him and makes him say what's wrong. He tells her that something terrible is going to happen at God's Tower. He doesn't want to put Knight and Nahani in danger, so he's going to go alone. Of course, that doesn't fly and they're going with Baby no matter what. Before we leave, Arovin gives us the living toy Gabriel. It fully heals Knight and Baby for 50 PP. It's a lot right now, but very soon into this video, PP isn't going to be a worry anymore. And so we run back to God's Tower. Like Arovin said, Kalkanor and Ramal are no longer here, so I can cross the bridge and get inside. In this first room, I go east from the center into another room. It has a chest containing miracle armor, a 4-point upgrade over my Onyx armor. Back in the center of the last room, I go west into another. This room's chest has a miracle sword, 5 points stronger than the Onyx sword. And then back in the first room, I take the northern door for a chest with a miracle shield inside, 4 points more than the Onyx shield. Back in the center of the first room, I take the stairs to the west going up. It leads to a chest with a spinach snack inside. Then back down and up the stairs to the east. This next room is just going clockwise up several sets of stairs. I get the only new enemy in this place, the Hangry. Killing these first two gets me over 10,000 XP and Knight to level 42. I then reach the end of the screen and move to the next. More clockwise stair climbing. Halfway up this screen is a chest with a snooze weed inside. Next screen. More clockwise stair climbing, with the first battle getting Baby to level 42. Halfway up this screen is a hole in the wall where I can rest and save for free. Up the stairs from the rest hole is a chest with a fire ring inside, which I have replaced the Cobra ring. Now I decide it's the best time to farm money to max out all the items at Zed Harbor, since I have a feeling the moment I lose access to its shops is coming soon. I have enemies granting huge amounts of XP and money, and a free healing spot close by. My next recording starts when I've maxed out my money at 999,999 rubies. Knight has reached level 58, and Baby has reached level 57 in that time. Next comes a huge journey back to the southwestern corner of the continent, and then the long water bug ride to Zed Harbor. With the money I've built up, I max out the item counts for Pirate Sword, Sage Sword, Viking Sword, Laminated Armor, Brigand Armor, Studded Armor, Viking Armor, Wooden Helmet, Iron Helmet, Full Shield, Pirate Shield, Studded Shield, Viking Shield, Candy Bar, Hamburger, Cheeseburger, Peach Potion, Bubblegum, Terra Seed, Go-Go Bean, and Snooze Weed. My remaining money then gets me 30 Brave Rings. That's 21 maxed out items from one cycle. The rest aren't gonna get me that much. Next recording, I finally discovered my Elgato removed my brightness settings and fixed them. Next time my money is maxed, both Knight and Baby are level 80. This spending spree maxes out Brave Rings and gets me 30 Wake Rings. On my way back through Triskan, I'd built up enough money to buy a Ring of Calm, which prevents confusion when equipped. Next money grind gets Knight and Bay bit to level 102. Yep, the game's levels go past 100. I never got a consistent answer on what the actual level cap is. The highest the game's code allows is in the 65,000s, but it's not actually possible through regular gameplay. I've heard three different caps, in the 32,000s, 10,000 and 9,999. Starting to get why I never maxed levels yet? Although as you'll find out next episode, I gave it a bloody good go. You only need to be about level 50 to beat the game, I think. I maxed out the Wake Ring, Mystical Sword, Smash Sword, Rain Sword and by 4 Elven Swords with what was left. Next grind gets both of them to level 125. I max out Elven Sword, Eelskin Armour, Rock Plate, Neptune's Armour, Elven Sword, Viking Helmet, Eelskin Shield, Marble Shield, Oyster Shield and get 72 Elven Shield before I run out. Then I get them both to level 147 with the next grind. I max out Elven Shield and get 97 Cobra Rings. Then my bastard Elgato reverted the brightness settings on its own again. Knight got to level 170 and Baby to level 169. I max out Cobra Rings and get 97 Heat Rings. This was the last item to max out here, so I grinded out at sea to quickly buy the last three. I skimmed over that pretty quick I'd say, but that was 2 days of grinding. By the time I make it back to God's Tower to save, both Knight and Baby have reached level 171. With all that done, I finally go up the stairs to the next screen. There's this giant red thing that welcomes Baby back to his home. However, Carmine hacks in and reboots it, making it attack us. Anzo has 1170 HP. Its first attack confuses Baby, but by this point Baby is doing over 300 damage with an attack, while Knight is doing 500 due to all the level ups. The double digit damage we receive also doesn't inspire worry, now I have over 13,000 HP. Yeah, my grind has obliterated the remaining challenge in this game. Well, steamrolling over an RPG with another powered party has its own satisfaction. Anzo drops the living toy Dark Cross. It reduces everyone's resistance to light elemental damage. I then take the teleporter to the next screen. It leads to more clockwise stair climbing. Knight reaches level 172 from the first battle here. There's a chest with a peach potion on the way up and I move on to the next screen. More clockwise stairs and then the next screen with even more. This one has a chest with a spinach snack. Right after, Baby reaches level 172. On the next floor there's another robot waiting for us. Lanzo tells Baby that Celestia was worried about him, before Carmine also takes this one over. Lanzo has 1390 HP, and also in battle its name is listed as Ranzi instead. Gotta love the gigantic triple laser only doing 1 damage to Knight. 4 hits is all it takes to bring this one down. Lanzo drops the living toy Holy Cross, which reduces everyone's resistance to dark elemental damage. The teleporter takes me to a room with a few more stairs to the top floor. But we're too late, as we see Carmine standing over a dragon bleeding out onto the floor. Carmine is confused, as he was led to believe that Shizan was sealed inside this dragon. He reasons that she must have given the final holy stone to the stork. Baby is devastated to see his mother lying cut open and runs up to her face to try and wake her up. Okay, I admit that got me to feel something. It's seeing those witnessing personal tragedy but aren't capable of fully comprehending it or understanding why it's happening, like really young kids or animals, that gets me. Carmine realises that Celestia hid the final stone in Baby and flew him away with the stork. He takes a stone, wounding Baby and undoing the seal on Shizan, the god of darkness, who he intends to have under his control. While undoing the seal, he reveals his full name to be Artemer Carmine. He orders all of his followers, the ones running his cult, to mutate into monsters. He's interrupted by Darkbeat and Ikbee. Carmine says via Tule and his followers, powered by Shizan, will completely take over the world for him. We also learn that he was the one who turned Ikbee into a dragon dinosaur walrus. The two of them then take on Carmine while we watch, but we can see the two don't have much of a chance when their attacks only do a third of the damage Carmine's does. His signature attack is Phoenix Dive, a bit like M. Bison's Psycho Crusher. Ikbee is taken out first, and Carmine targets Darkbeat with another attack, Checkmate, which calls lightning down on Darkbeat. It's not long before he's down too. Darkbeat still demands Carmine change Ikbee back, to which Carmine says that Darkbeat was stronger when he was still working for him. He also says that the only way to restore Ikbee's true form is to kill him. After just standing still gawking at everything, Knight finally gets involved. Carmine has 2550 HP. Since I'm alone, I do start by bringing out Contributor, who deals a massive 850 damage on the opening attack. I then attack for over 400, and then Contributor follows up by dealing over 1100, taking out Carmine and winning me the fight without being hit. Carmine is in complete disbelief at his loss, but says it's too late to stop Shizan's return. He commands Shizan to take him and bring darkness to the world. He then disappears. I talk to Baby, which makes Nahani also break down at how unfair the loss of his mother is after everything he went through to get here. Celestia is still just barely alive though, and calls out to Baby. She casts some sort of magic onto Baby and heals him. But that took the last of her strength, and when Baby walks back up to her, she's already gone. Darkbeat starts to get up, and in the middle of thanking Night for his help, God's Tower starts to shake. It's the unsealing of Shizan. Darkbeat tells us we have to leave, but Baby wants to stay with his mum. Nahani talks him around and we go to leave. The voice of the old man who gave Night his quest tells Celestia that she did well and not to worry, as Night and Baby will definitely finish the job. Everyone's made it to the entrance and Darkbeat tells Ikbee to carry Night and Baby away on her back. There isn't enough space for them all, so Darkbeat intends to stay to give the others a chance to escape. But Baby has other ideas and has Night get on his back. Celestia has granted Baby the ability to fly. And so Baby carries Night and Ikbee carries Darkbeat as God's Tower is annihilated behind them, knocking them away, and Shizan appears in its place. He grows wings from his back and flies off into the sky. I hear a voice say that it will still take some time for Shizan to restore his full strength. Another voice says that Shizan can be sealed again, but Carmine has all the holy stones and Night still hasn't reached his full potential. So Darkbeat says they should start looking for the holy armour, but after God's Tower, Darkbeat's in no condition to be going anywhere. The screen fades in on Darkbeat telling Ikbee this place is Picard, and it's safe. It also has some really nice music. He says Night and Baby are probably in the next room. Said next room is a huge mess of cubes with upside down crystal pyramids of stairs, and it's just Night, no Baby or Nahani. I get confused navigating the cubes in the corner to find a chest containing the living toy Verseus. This weakens everyone in the battle so that they take double damage. I leave this room into a big central room where I go east through another door. I go up the stairs and talk to the Picardian, who says that the party is now the only hope now Celestia is gone. I can also rest the free here. Back in the central room, I take the door in the southeast corner. Nahani's in here and so is Baby. Since they weren't conscious for Darkbeat's explanation, none of them know where they are. Next room I check out is the one in the southwest corner. Up the stairs in the corner is a chest containing a full plate. It's 1 point stronger than the miracle armour. Next comes a northwest room. This is Darkbeat's room. He says that if he knew Baby was Celestia's child, he could have worked with us to prevent Shizan's return. But with Baby having inherited some of Celestia's power, there's still hope. There are 4 pieces of the Holy Armour of Darwin to find. Darkbeat can't do it this time as the fight with Carmine has left him in an awful state. We've heard the name Darwin before, long ago. His grave was on the mountain road between Sanclaria and the Cave of Fear. All 4 pieces are scattered around the world. I just have to find them while he rests and bring them to him so that he can do the rest, since he is the chosen one. He also gives Night a working warp gate key, so I can now use them. Back in the central room, I take the eastern door and can finally get some information on what Picard is. It's a citadel containing the knowledge of many lost races, including the original Picardians. Another one says that it is impossible to seal Shizan in the same way he was previously. The only solution remaining is to destroy him completely. Next, I try the western room, which leads to a library. Nahani says they may find some information on the holy armour here. In the southwestern corner of the room is some stairs to the Book of Legends. I get to learn that Shizan was first summoned by a cruel race known as the Kalajic and laid waste to a huge amount of the world until Darwin showed up with the holy gems and sacred servant sent by God and sealed him away into a crystal. We even get to see a recap of it, showing the scope of Shizan's power as he wipes whole cities from existence. He's stopped by the sea serpent we saw in the Zephyr, along with Ruval, the Winged Lion, the Galestalk, and Celestia. All those who held a stone. And riding Celestia is Darwin, who looks a lot like a more mature knight. He throws a sword right into Shizan's eye before the 5 servants perform the seal. I find a book on the holy armour, telling me where the pieces are. In the Nord Temple in an icy land, in Kirpal, in Castle Ryan, and in Denim under a great tree. Only Kirpal is a place I've been before. There's the Book of Seals that explains that demons can be sealed by placing the 5 holy stones in a pyramid position, explaining how exactly Darwin sealed Shizan and why Kalkanor was searching for them. There's also the Book of Prophecy, explaining that Celestia sending her child away with a stone when danger comes was something decided centuries ago. But Nahani notes a part about Tears of Love and Solomon's power being used to trade one life for another. She says her mother used to sing her a song with the same words and told her that Solomon would make dreams come true. And when it comes to the name Solomon, we have a Solomon's ring, which fairies had a use for, but Nahani won't tell us. Back in the central room, I can enter the middle of the room to go upstairs. This floor leads to 4 rooms in each of the cardinal directions. First is east for a chest containing the Great Sword, 1 point stronger than the Miracle Sword. Then south, which just gets an empty ruin. North gets me a chest with a steel shield, 1 point stronger than the miracle shield, and the western room has nothing, so I go down a floor. I can now take the southern door in the central room, which is actually a warp gate. There are 8 doorways in here. I take the southern one, which turns out to be the one on Jungo Island I found last episode. Most people around the world have seen Shizan flying around, not surprising considering how huge he is. Bonic's shop, the Bonique, is finally open. Finding out all the ships were sunk, so he's unlikely to have many customers, has him beg Knight to buy anything from him. Despite claiming to give me a discount, he sells weapons at exorbitant prices. I buy the 62,000 Ruby Platinum Sword, the strongest sword in the game, 29 points stronger than the Greatsword. I also inspect one of his barrels for a spinach snack. There's also a hint towards a side quest that doesn't exist. The fool who let me name his child is without work thanks to all the ships being sunk. Nahani says we should help him out, but we can't actually do anything about it. Back inside the warp gate, I take the northeastern one. This one leads into Galak's basement in Carmarthen. He's just happy we proved his theories correct. I return to the mine. I talk to the miner in the northeast corner who found another living toy, so he gives it to me, Voodoo Doll. It kills one enemy every 4 turns, but at this point I can kill most things quicker than that. Back into the warp gate, I take the southwestern gate to exit east of Den Heldar. Everyone is very pessimistic about their chances of surviving Shizan here. Even an old man who says he's lived through several bad situations thinks this is it for him. There's a detective in the middle of town who's all, "Fuck this, I'm out, I'm going home," and gives me the living toy Sir Mo. If this is brought out before a party member death, it will automatically revive them. I return to Jungo, and now Baby can fly, I can make him do it from the menu. Flying is much more convenient than using Chester, as I can start flying from any outdoor spot. I cannot land inside towns, however, but that's barely a problem. The flying theme is also so much better than Chester's. Always love that bit in a classic RPG where you get your form of flight after a dark moment and it plays one of the game's best tracks. It's predictable, but it works on me nearly every time. We now have full freedom over the world and can travel anywhere we want, but there's some unfinished business in a few old towns. Remember, Carmine ran the Artema cult, which operated in many towns, and he commanded them to mutate into demons before he disappeared. So first I return to Zed Harbor to find it overrun by demons. By the docks is the lead demon, Bosmi, who orders the rest of them to kill all the humans. They spread out around the town and I have to track them down. The first one is right behind me cornering a sailor. I kill the Beakwing in 2 hits. It is kind of funny that they have the danger music playing uninterrupted in town and through the battles, but the victory fanfare is still too powerful and overrides it. The next Beakwing has another sailor cornered near the governor's house. They all have the same HP, so they all die in 2 hits. Next one is in the northeast corner outside the church. Killing this one gets Knight to level 173. Slightly to the south is the last Beakwing. With them all dead, I return to Bosmi. He has 2500 HP. It's quite a bit, and while I'm under no threat, I still bring out Contributor to speed things up. Bosmi's signature attack is to snot over the entire party. Nice. He's dead in 2 turns. And that's Zed Harbor freed. It looks like the governor is thankful for my help, but under his breath, he says he's just flattering me to secure a future vote. I'm not even a Zed Harbor citizen, I can't vote for him regardless. He also rewards me with the living toy Cheer Girl. This boosts my attack power, as if I have to worry about that at this level. The shops have closed out of fear of another demon attack, so I maxed out all the items at the best possible time. Next I fly all the way to Triskan, having only just learned I can display a map in the corner of the screen. This place is also under attack by the Artema cult. First I take out the wing beak attacking the recruiter. The second one is around the corner from the weapon shop. The third one is rampaging around the fountain in the town square. The fourth is by the western gate, and the fifth is just around the corner from it. The sixth wing beak is in front of the castle gates, and the seventh is just east of the bridge leading to them. Killing this one gets Baby to level 173. The eighth and final wing beak is to the west of the weapon shop. In front of the inn is the sorcerer commanding them, Org. Org has 1000 HP, but he starts by summoning a giant bird, Velmeen, to take me on. Velmeen has 1600 HP and a fire attack. I take it down in no time while Org uses his one attack on me. I turn to him and take him down in a couple hits too. With this town saved, I go talk to the king, who's been filled in on everything by Ramal when she and Kalkanar were brought here. He gives me the living toy Generosity, which when used gives me either money or an item at the end of the battle. Kalkanar and Ramal are resting upstairs. Despite there being 2 beds, Kalkanar has to recover on a chair for some reason. Both of them are in no condition to do anything else. Next town to revisit is Garum, since it also had an Artema church here. These lot haven't attacked the town yet, but I still inspect the church. I listen in and hear monster voices, so I go inside and talk to the cult member. She accidentally outs herself when she mentions being mid-mutation, so I take down another Beakwing. Knight reaches level 174. That's all, and I've cleared out the cult's presence in Garum. By inspecting the statue, I can pick up an infinite supply of spinach stacks, so I max out on those. I go to leave, missing an important treasure I'll have to come back for later. Next place to revisit on our world tour is Kirple. There's nothing new with the people here, so I go back into the Ugonga Shrine. In the room where I fought Ugonga, I can now go north for a new exit in the back. I cross a long bridge and reach a teleporter in the back that responds to the warp gate key. There's a guardian in here like the one in the North Tower. This one is protecting a piece of holy armour. The guardian has 1600 HP, and since I'm so powerful, I just very quickly beat it down. This lets me open the chest containing the holy helmet. The Zepeto helmet is still stronger though. Next time I go northeast of Kirple and directly east of Den Heldar to find this castle I couldn't reach before Baby could fly. This is Castle Ryan. From the entrance I go all the way east into another room, I then follow this room into another. In this next room I go all the way south to another, then west to another. In the middle of this room is a chest containing a spinach snack, and then go north through the doorway slightly north of it. This leads to a corridor with a few rooms to the north and south. In the first room on the south is a chest with a sickweed inside. In the north room I get my first battle, as most enemies are terrified of me at this level. It's a new one, a swordster. The chest in this room gets me an earth ring, which makes me stronger against wind damage. Going further west there are two more rooms. Baby reaches level 174, and I open the chest for a toadstool. The north room has a cheeseburger. Moving west some more I face my first dark demon. Next pair of rooms. South gets me a toadstool, and north gets me a spinach snack. Going west some more then leads down some stairs to another screen. I go west and north, night reaching level 175. Then I turn east into another room. There's a chest with the living toy assassin, which is Mr. O'Neill with a machine gun, who has a chance to instantly kill an enemy. There's also this guy down here, the No Owl. He says that if I want to reach the heart of the castle, I need to turn on all four red switches. He also offers me a free rest and save. With that, I use Foreman to return to the castle entrance and get moving directly south until I go through a doorway. It leads to a chest containing a dark plate, but it's weaker than my full plate. I face my first iron golem here, and go southeast from the chest and up some stairs into a room that leads to a chest with the living toy Classique. This puts everything to sleep. There's also a red switch here that I press. Nahani thinks it's broken, but No Owl did say to press all four. Back in the previous room, I go up the stairs in the northeast corner. This room has a chest with the living toy Confuso, which confuses everyone, and the second switch to press. To the previous room again, and up the stairs in the northwest corner. This time the chest gets me the living toy Dr. Gas, which poisons everyone. I also press the third switch. Finally, at the southwest corner, where I press the fourth switch and hear movement elsewhere. The chest gets me the living toy Freaks, which inflicts terror on everyone. That's all the corners, but there's still some side rooms I can reach as well. In the previous room, there's a doorway to the west leading to a chest that gets me a dark sword. I already have the strongest sword in the game, so any new ones I find will be downgrades. There's a side room to the east with a chest containing a dark shield. I then return to the previous room again, and go south of the chest into a new doorway, leading to another teleporter, leading to another guardian. This guardian has 1800 HP and takes just 4 hits to kill, getting Baby to level 175. The chest it leaves behind contains the Holy Sword. The legendary sword required to take on an unstoppable demon is weaker than the one I can just buy from a shop. That's all for this place, so I leave. I travel a long distance north to this field east of Orgo Village across a river. This is Denine Plains, and I run around this giant tree stump looking for a way inside. First thing I do is go west into another room. It gets me a chest with quilted armour inside. Back to the entrance and south into another room. The chest in here gets me the Living Toy Resetter, which resets the battle to the beginning if things aren't going your way. Then back to the entrance and east into another room, then a short tunnel to another. First I go north in this room for a chest with a spinach snack, and then south and east to another room. Another tunnel with nothing in it, and then another, just going deeper and deeper. It leads to another tree stump, but behind it is a chest with a twisted shield. I then go through the crack in the tree stump to find the teleporter, but first behind it is a chest with a twisted sword inside. The teleporter takes me to another guardian. This one has 1700 HP and also takes 4 hits to the feet. The chest this one drops gets me the holy armour. That's all, back to flying. After going through a couple dungeons, I return to Bonic's shop. Now I can afford the game's strongest armour, the platinum plate, and the strongest helmet, the platinum helmet. I next get flying northeast to reach the northern continent, a place I couldn't reach at all without Baby's flight. I first land outside the only town on this continent, Pengui. We did meet one of the people from here in Jungo. The first person I talk to thinks Darkbeat's gonna kick Shizan's ass, but Nahani ends up in an argument with him when she says Darkbeat's currently injured and he calls her a silly dragonfly because Darkbeat is invincible. It ends with him calling for his mother, like a coward. South of the town entrance I inspect this snowman to find the living toy Fruz in its hat. This turns an enemy into a block of ice. The town mayor thinks that Shizan is Santa somehow. There's a fishing penguin who sees Shizan and just wonders what he could catch with him if he used him as bait. He thinks he's just caught a fish, but it just turns out to be a living toy, so he gives it to me. Mermaid just does water damage. In the igloo slightly south of him, the owner will let me rest for free. Inspecting his fire will have him let me take a candy bar. In the igloo just south of that one, I can inspect this sack for an apple, but Knight feels guilty stealing. I do not. My 100% comes before all else. Outside, I can meet the mother of Pengi, the one I met in Jungo. I also talked to Pengi's siblings to get some backstory on Fruze. Darkbeak gave it to Pengi with the intention that all of them could play with it, but Pengi didn't want to share, so he hid it in the snowman. Well, it's mine now. None of them can have it. That's it for this place, and I get travelling north, facing my first Christus on the way. Next new enemy is a whipneck. I reach a dead end on foot and have to fly the last little bit of a journey to the Nord Temple. First room is just a straight line north. I then get heading east, battling my first Ivies. Killing these grants Baby his final transformation, and also gets Knight to level 176. I enter the next room and follow it around and up the stairs to another. Baby reaches level 176. Then I realise I read the guide wrong and return to the previous room. Instead I go north, battling my first Hydra. There's a chest off to the west with some Obro armour, and I head north some more, splitting off west again for a chest with a Wind Ring. I keep going north until I reach another screen. This room has a chest with an Obro shield inside. I go back, Knight reaching level 177, and at the southern end of the room, go west into another. I go west up a lot of stairs to the next screen, where I find the living toy Draken. This one takes half of both the party and the enemy's HP. Bit useless for me right now. I then take that eastern route I abandoned. I face a new enemy this time through, the Tentaclite. It gets Baby to level 177. Out of the tunnels is this long path west, and then north to another doorway. It leads to this kind of maze of slippery surfaces. I start with the one directly in front of me, and then the one to the east. Knight reaches level 178, and I enter this room to find a chest getting me an Aztec sword. From here, I slide down the western slope and enter another for a chest with the living toy Frostall. As the name implies, it freezes everyone. I slide down the slope in front of me and go all the way west to enter another room. It puts me in a pair of tunnels leading to another penguin who gives me a place to rest and save. I head east to the end of the tunnel, and it puts me back in the slope room but higher up. I slide down the one in front of me, then the one all the way to the west, the next one on the west, and the one after to reach another room with a teleporter inside. I take on the final guardian with 1700 HP, who dies in 4 hits like the others. The chest it leaves behind contains a holy shield. That's the full set of holy armour collected, but there's still some more things left to do. First I return to Jungo, and now I have the money to buy the platinum shield, fully equipping me with the game's strongest equipment. Next I return to Rogo's tunnel. He's been digging some more and found me another living toy, Avalanche, which performs an earth attack. My next target is northwest of God's Tower, so while flying by, I get to see how it's been completely wiped out with only a bit of the bridge remaining. It can be a bit tricky to find, but it's marked down on the map. One last dungeon for this episode, Kisa Canyon. Part of the gimmick with this dungeon is that the foliage at the top of the screen is covering parts of your view. It can be a pain when I just want to find chests. First I go north to find a chest with a cheeseburger. I get going southwest, facing my first Zane, some kind of floating pregnant seahorse. It gets Baby to level 178. Continuing west leads me to another screen. I keep moving west along the north of the screen to find a passage to the next, but then I spend ages looking for a chest before finding it's about a third of the way along the room, hidden behind the environment. It's an attack sword and I can move on to a third screen. I move north onto a fourth screen where I head west some more and face my first lizard man. I take the first north to find a chest containing a spinach snack. I get going west again to a fifth screen. Then I go west some more into a cave. I follow the path west, making sure to take a quick detour east for a chest with the living toy ninja. This one just attacks with cool ninja skills or something. I never used it. That was the last chest in the game, by the way. I then continue to the next screen, where at the end is the Holy Dragon, the last remaining sacred servant, and what I saw before I was thrown from the Zephyr. She believes I'm part of Kalkanor's group and was in on stealing her stone. She survived Kalkanor's attack and goes for us. She has 1100 HP and goes down in 3 attacks. Nahani feels bad for killing her, even if we were defending ourselves. Inspecting her waters gets us the living toy D'Artagnan, which attacks enemies with a spear. This does explain why she started sinking ships. She was looking for the travelling group that stole her stone and wanted to get rid of them before they could gather the rest. I return to Zepeto's house, where he says he's working on one last living toy that will be finished by the time I find the others. I'm confused, as I was certain D'Artagnan was the last one I needed. So I get looking through a list and compare to what I have, and remember when I said I missed something in the Artema church in Garum? Yeah, I got distracted by the infinite spinach snack statue and forgot to go for the chest in the opposite room. This one gets me Championo, who takes half of my maximum PP in exchange for insane damage. I return them to Zeppetto, who asks to see them all. He says he never thought he'd see them again, but when Nahani says she thought his grandfather made them, he tells the truth. He is the original Professor Zeppetto, and hands us his final creation he's been working on for years, Legend. We'll see Legend next episode. He's basically a ghost, clinging to the living world after death to finish his life's work. But with that, he can move on. O'Neill says it makes sense, Zeppetto never had children. And that's what I meant last episode when I said there was a hint of sadness to his house's theme, and as soon as I got to this part I realised why. At first it's just the cosy music of this grandfather figure who makes toys for you. Then you realise it's the theme of a long dead man who can't move on yet. Not through some lingering resentment or need for revenge or anything like that, but due to his will to help people. Spending decades in seclusion to try to make the world a safer place. This is a very simple game, but there are some things below the surface if you want to find them. I'd end it here, but there's one last thing to do. With these 69 living toys, please don't, obtained, I return to Knight's house in Orgo Village and go to sleep. And when I wake up, there's suddenly a 70th living toy next to my bed. Nahani says they found it years ago when they were playing by the beach. O'Neill says that it's a prototype Zeppetto made after he made Championo. It was even more destructive and he named it Peacemaker. It was thought that Zeppetto destroyed it because it was too powerful. Nahani believes he tried but couldn't bring himself to. Peacemaker reduces all participants in the battle to 1 HP. And that is almost everything done in this game. I really enjoyed the world tour we had, getting new stuff in all places, new dungeons, the endgame plot in general, and the resolution to Zeppetto's story. Next time we'll be finishing this game, maxing out all the remaining item counts and taking on Shizan. Back to Guardians Crusade one last time. Last time we pretty much accomplished everything, obtained all the holy armour and all the living toys. So story-wise, all that's left is the end of the game. But first, as part of my 100%, I'm going to max out the remaining item count and level myself as high as I can bear to. But first I have to figure out the best place to farm money, as my previous grinding spot was wiped off the face of the planet. I look up what little information I can find to discover that there are certain spots only reached by flying where enemies are always set to a higher level than you. But this turns out to not be very efficient at all, as this means these enemies take forever to kill and they don't even give me enough XP to make it worth it. There's enemies I can kill in one or two hits that grant more than that. In the end, I decide to try the Nord Temple, as I can kill the enemies quickly and it gives rewards comparable to or maybe even above God's Tower. When my money is maxed out, Knight and Baby are at level 196. It takes me around 50 to 60 minutes per money maxing cycle and gets me about 20 levels each time. Now for a world tour spending spree. First is Istan, since it's the closest place I haven't maxed out all the items in. I max out Angel's Tear, Mind Berry, Freedom Root, Sick Weed, Rotten Weed, Toadstool, Short Sword, Long Sword, Copper Sword, Iron Sword, Leather Armour, Padded Armour, Studded Armour, Iron Armour, Wood Shield, Wicker Shield, Copper Shield, Iron Shield, and the rest gets me up to 82 Rings of Calm. Next grind gets them both to level 217. Back to Istan, I max out the Ring of Calm and get myself 82 Freedom Rings. My next grind has Knight at level 240 and Baby at level 239. Back to Istan to get those last 18 Freedom Rings. Next place is Carmarthen, where I max out the Wooden Cross, Dragon Sword, Scorpion Sword, Dwarf Sword, Dragon Armour, and get 46 Scorpion Plates before I run out. Another hour in the Nord Temple and Knight is at level 260 while Baby is level 259. Back to Carmarthen, I max out Scorpion Plate, Dwarven Mail, Roman Armour, Dragon Shield, Scorpion Shield, Dwarven Shield, and just enough to get up to 4 Zeus' Shield. Another grind gets both of them to level 280. To Carmarthen once again to max out Zeus' Shield. That's this place bought out. Next is Denheldar. I max out Jousting Sword and Cobra Sword, then get myself 8 Swords of Ra. Next recording has Knight at level 301 and Baby at level 300. I max out the Sword of Ra and the Kuldian Sword, then get 37 Jousting Armours. My next grinding session gets both party members to level 321. I max out Jousting Armour, Cobra Armour, and can afford 86 Armours of Ra before I run out. When I make it all back again, Knight is level 342 and Baby is level 341. Knight has also maxed out the HP stat at 32,767. I max out Armour of Ra, Kuldian Armour and Jousting Shield and get 28 Cobra Shields with what was left over. My 10th money maxing session has the party at level 362. I max out Cobra Shield, Shield of Ra and buy 60 Kuldian Shield with the leftovers. By the way, those 22 leopard shields were enemy drops from my grind in God's Tower last episode. Level 383 for Knight and level 382 for Baby next time. I finish off Denheldar by maxing out Kuldian shields. Next revisit is Triskan. First the Flower Girl to max out both the Lily and the Rose. Then in the shops, I max out the Eagle Sword and run out after 40 Crusader Swords. Next time, both of them are at level 403. I max out Crusader Swords and get 57 Crusher Swords. Level 424 for Knight and 423 for Baby. I max out Hawk Sword, Crusher Sword and get 85 Eagle Plates. Next time they're both at level 444. I max out Eagle Plate and Crusader Armour. The leftover gets me 62 Hawk Armours. Level 464 next time for both of them. I max out Hawk Armour, Chainmail and buy 27 Eagle Shields with what's left. Knight reaches level 485 and Baby level 484. I max out Eagle Shield and Crusader Shield, ending with 13 Hawk Shields. Next, level 505 for both of them. I max out Hawk Shield and buy 75 Granite Shields. Another hour and Knight is level 526 while Baby is level 525. I max out Granite Shield, Cleaver Sword and buy 22 Black Swords with the leftover. Knight gets to level 546 and Baby level 545. I max out Black Sword and get 55 Celtic Swords. We're getting into the expensive stuff, so things are really gonna slow down now. Next time, Knight is level 567 and Baby is 566. I max out Celtic Swords and buy 79 Demon Swords. Then I get Knight to level 587 and Baby to 586. I max Demon Sword and Bar Mail and get 19 Black Plates with what's left. Both of them then reach level 607. I am over 12 times the average level for finishing this game. I max out Black Plate and buy 52 Celtic Plates. Knight level 628 and Baby level 627. I max out Celtic Plates and buy 76 Leopard Armors. Then both of them are level 648. That's 20 million XP each there. I max out Leopard Armor and Marble Shield and buy 16 Black Shields. Knight gets to level 669 and Baby to level 668. I max out Black Shield and buy 49 Celtic Shields. Level 689 next for both of them. I max Celtic Shield and buy 94 Leopard Shields. Next recording starts with Knight at level 710 and Baby level 709. I can then buy the last 6 Leopard Shields and max out every item from Triskan. It took gaining 327 levels just for this place. I next fly over to Garum and max out the Royal Sword and with what's left get 7 Artesian Swords. Then they're both level 730. I max out Artesian Sword and get my count of Onyx Swords to 14. Knight reaches level 751 and Baby level 750. I max out Onyx Sword and buy 16 Royal Armors. My 30th money maxing session gets both of them to level 771. I max out Royal Armor and buy 26 Artesian Armors. Next Knight is level 792 and Baby level 791. I max Artesian Armor and buy 26 Onyx Armors. Then they both reach level 812. I max Onyx Armor and buy 25 Royal Shields. Knight reaches level 833 and Baby level 832. I max Royal Shield and buy 34 Artesian Shields. Max the money again and both are level 853. I max Artesian Shield and buy 34 Onyx Shields. Another hour gets both of them to level 873. I max out Onyx Shields, getting everything from Garum and gaining 164 levels on the way. That just leaves Jungo, which I was saving for last due to Bonic's expensive equipment. The last of my money gets me 31 Flame Swords. I get Knight to level 894 and Baby to 893. I max out Flame Swords and buy 31 Water Swords. Both of them reach level 917 and I max the Water Sword and buy 31 Gaian Swords. Then Knight gets to level 935 and Baby to level 934. I max out Gaian Swords and buy 31 Avian Swords. Level 955 for Knight and 954 for Baby. I max out Avian Swords and buy 31 Swords of Chaos. Both of them hit level 975. I max out Sword of Chaos and buy 32 Swords of Order. Knight reaches level 996 and Baby 995. I max out Sword of Order and buy 5 Platinum Swords with what's left. From now on, it'll take several money maxing sessions to max out just one of the Platinum equipment. So by the time I buy all 100 Platinum Swords, Knight is level 1119 and Baby is level 1118. Now on to Platinum Plays. When I had the money to buy all of them, Knight is level 1262 and Baby is level 1261. This time I get a little head start, as when it comes to buying the Platinum Helmets, I'm starting with over 800 grand. When I reach 100 Platinum Helmets, Knight is level 1387 and Baby level 1386. Just a Platinum Shield left now. And that ends with Knight at level 1509 and Baby at level 1508. I think I'm done, but then I remember that Jungo has a second weapon shop I used much earlier in the game. I max out the White Sword and buy 28 Broadswords. So it's back to farming money and I get Knight to level 1529 and Baby to level 1528. I max out Broadsword, Thunder Sword, Fire Sword and buy 74 white armors. Another session and I get both of them to level 1549. I max out white armor, bone plate, thunder plate, fire armor and buy 18 white shields. Another session and Knight is level 1570 while Baby is level 1569. I max out the White Shield, Bone Shield, Thunder Shield and buy 71 Fire Shields. One more money maxing session and I get both of them to level 1590. I can finally max out the Fire Shield and that's every item that can be bought at a shop maxed out. But there are still other items to max out. The majority of this was done off screen. I finally use Baby's Fetch option. This will send Baby out for a few seconds and he'll either come back with a random item or nothing. Or sometimes he'll refuse to search. This allows me to get items that are either exclusive to enemy drops or would otherwise be unique. So that time I reset the game because I accidentally fed Baby the water ring, I can just get more through this. In the end I can get 100 of every item in the game except for the Chester Flute, Warp Gate Key and the Holy Armor pieces. There's even a few items only found through searching that have no gameplay function than to exist in the inventory. But this took several nights in a row just constantly telling Baby to fetch. According to the dates on my recordings, this took me 17 nights between 1 and 3 hours. What also slowed things down is that as this went on, Baby would refuse to fetch more and more often. Eventually Baby refused to go fetch completely relatively close to the end, so with around 200 items left to grab. Go fetch seems to lower his happiness, and once he runs out he refuses all go fetch requests. So I had to keep feeding him food to get him searching again. But as I needed only 30 more items to max out all items, successful searches became less and less common, and soon I'd be having entire feeding cycles without getting a single one. So I went back to grinding. I'd feed Baby a lot of platinum swords to bump up his stats, and then grind the money back as usual. Once I maxed out money once again, I'd use the buildup of happiness for another long go fetch session. Or so I thought. It turns out gaining Baby 20 levels barely put up his happiness at all, and just force feeding him like 12 wooden helmets was more efficient. Of course, when I do get the final item, it's the one recording out of the 82 recording sessions that came out all fucked up, blurry and jittery, and I have no idea why. But through my 2.5 weeks of making Baby look for items, I also maxed out the long-legged bug, happy letter, sad letter, seashell, spring, lid, headless doll, record, bronze sword, buccaneer sword, sword of might, crystal sword, attack sword, twisted sword, Aztec sword, Zeus's sword, Dark Sword, Miracle Sword, Great Sword, Bronze Mail, Buccaneer Mail, Koldian Armor, Crystal Armor, Quilted Armor, Obro Armor, Splint Mail, Dark Plate, Miracle Armor, Full Plate, Zepetto Helmet, Bronze Shield, Tower Shield, Bone Shield, Crystal Shield, Twisted Shield, Obro Shield, Devil Shield, Dark Shield, Miracle Shield, Steel Shield, Water Ring, Fire Ring, Wind Ring and Earth Ring. And that's all I'm gonna do before finishing the game. I did consider trying for max levels and Baby stats, but considering getting to where I am took 150 hours, plus how inefficient raising Baby stats is with a cap of over 32,000, I had to admit defeat on that one. That's too far and would probably take me several hundred more hours. I admit I felt bad not going all that way, but on the other hand, how many people who've played this game got to level 1671? Well, to continue the plot I have to equip all the holy armour. The platinum stuff may be better, but I'm so far above everything right now that it no longer matters. I return to Picard and talk to Darkbee. Darkbee tries to put on the armour, but it won't let him. Maybe because it's already on my body, I have them equipped. Nahani suggests Knight try, and it works for him. Turns out Darkbee was never the chosen one, it was Knight, and then they suddenly teleport away. They're taken to a room where a figure looking similar to Knight is waiting. It's Darwin. After all the guardians I had to face for his armour, the final test is to take on Darwin himself. The change in armour also changes Knight's attack animation, and his levels allow him to take out all 300 of Darwin's HP in one attack. His victory animation is changed too. Darwin says they have proven their worthiness and that Shizan is hiding in a storm cloud, preparing to rain down destruction on the planet. Darwin is going to use the last of his power to send us there. We then suddenly see Knight and Baby zooming through the sky at incredible speed. As we approach, Nahami spots Carmine. His attempts to control Shizan ended badly as Shizan saw his wounds and turned him into a monster. Just like how he turned Glor into a monster when Glor was no longer useful to him. But we don't have to waste our time with him, as Darkbeat and Ikbee show up with a score to settle. Since he's still alive, Ikbee still can't regain her human form. Darkbeat sends us off to take on Shizan while he fights Carmine. And so we get to watch one last automated fight between them. I respect that they made this new elaborate design for Carmine with all new attacks and animations for a battle we don't even get to play, but they wanted it to close this subplot out properly. Darkbeat and Ikbee retain their move list from before, but Carmine now has an electric lance and can detach his new wings to shoot giant red electric balls. Although this does bring up the question of who's holding up Darkbeat here, since Ikbee's right next to him and they're fighting in the sky. However, we don't get to see the outcome of this battle as the screen fades out. As the party approach Shizan, Nahari decides to get a few things off her chest while she still has the chance. First asking if Knight can remember the day they first left Argo and saying how she can't believe how much they've been through since. That's always how I feel replaying certain RPGs and reliving the laid back beginnings after you've grown accustomed to the endgame stakes. She asks Knight if he remembers the day they met. Knight found her one day injured in the woods and took care of her, and she stayed with him since. She asks Knight whether they could have ever been more than friends if she was a human. She says she just wanted to know, but the battle with Shizan interrupts. Shizan has HP. Based on the sheer amount of damage I'm doing with every hit, I believe the battle is either scripted or Shizan has a level that scales to yours. Something also messed with Baby's AI and he started the battle attacking me. Shizan shows his level of threat by using his Haven's Wall, an eye laser that creates a huge fiery explosion around us. He can also whip with his tentacles. I actually use Gabriel here as well for that full heal, my massive PP making the full heal essentially free. I get to see a move that's never showed up from Baby, where he transforms into a massive glove and punches. Eventually Nahani says we just aren't damaging him. Baby tries talking to Knight, and on my next turn his command menu suddenly has a guardian option. This is Baby's true final transformation, and one that can only be used here. Based on the shape, I assume this is what Baby looks like with his mother's full power. Baby has the seal technique, forming the same prison shape Shizan was trapped in before and throwing it at him. He also gains the move Final Charge, where he rams into Shizan at full strength. After enough damage, Shizan looks to be defeated and shrinks into the pyramid shape Baby put around him. Nahani celebrates over Shizan being sealed again and it all being over. We get the victory animation, but remember what that guy in Picard said last episode? That Shizan cannot be sealed away again, only destroyed completely? The seal is shattered and phase 2 begins. Shizan has now taken the form of some giant bat demon with a black hole stomach. Once again, Baby starts by headbutting me. This time I get pulling out some of the living toys I haven't used yet. First is Championo, rapidly punching Shizan for 257 hits and damage so high the counter rolled over and only said 107. Shizan has a blood-sucking move that heals himself for the amount of damage he deals. Next comes Legend, who charges through Shizan for just under 7,000 damage. Shizan follows up with his forbidden spell, Armageddon. It sucks in the party and blasts them all around the screen, instantly KOing both of them. Nahani desperately tries to wake Knight up, but he's not budging. Her only option is to use the Ring of Solomon. Remember the prophecy about Solomon and Picard, about trading one life for another? Knight tries to stop her, but it doesn't work. She uses the ring, causing severe damage to Shizan. She appears before Knight, the same size as him, and they embrace, fully healing him. She also heals Baby, but then fades away, leaving just the final phase of the battle to begin. As usual, Baby starts the battle attacking me. Shizan is now all withered, his black hole stomach gone too. I once again start with Championo, but Shizan still has powerful new attacks like Hell's Wind, dealing around 4,000 damage. I finally use Walk Bomb, where I learn I built up 6,000 damage in steps over the game. Baby uses another new attack, turning into a sword and cutting through Shizan. And then Legend comes out again, dealing the final blow. Shizan is destroyed completely. As his remains fade away, we get the credits, showing long pans of the places we visited. We get to see many of the people we've met, living in peace or celebrating Shizan's death. Even Chester makes a cameo after I practically dumped him once Baby could fly. Kalkanor and Ramal look to have recovered from their injuries. Aruvin still seems to be making zombies though, someone should probably do something about that. More importantly, we get to see who won the battle with Carmine, as we get to see Ikbee in her human form. And we end the game on a first-person view of someone walking through Argo Village to Knight's house. As we get to the door, we can see it's Baby as he knocks. Remember how the Solomon's Ring also supposedly makes dreams come true? Well, it granted Nahani's wish of becoming human. Now she and Knight live together as a couple, raising baby as their own child. And isn't that just very nice? We don't always have to have a bittersweet aspect to the ending. Not that I want every game to be happy all the time, but sometimes it's nice to have a game end where everything's just nice. And I gotta say, this game is very simple, with simple gameplay, simple graphics, little difficulty and a simple story. But I really liked it. There was those little bits there I mentioned before, like Zeppetto's subplot. Baby's just a really endearing sidekick. And I was surprised how likeable Nahani was for someone who was just supposed to be the silent hero's mouthpiece. To the point that, once again, them all finishing up as a family was just nice. I can see myself playing this game again in a similar way I do Final Fantasy IV, something where I just want to chill with an RPG and not have to put too much effort into. This dethroned State of Emergency as the most pleasant surprise I've had on this channel from a new game I'd never touched or heard of before. Hell, unlike that game, which I owned before starting these videos, this game is something I can thank making these videos for, as I discovered it specifically looking for a new game I could cover. And that's one of the reasons I started this channel, regain the motivation to playing through new games, whether I already owned them before or not.